that's nice. When I'm down in New Orleans, people always give you a good morning, but it's nice to hear it here too. Because sometimes in New York, when you give a good morning, it's like, oh, good morning. You know? So anyway, I had a fantasy about these poles in the middle of the room. It's like, if you don't listen or you don't participate, I'm going to get cuffs. I'm going to cuff you to the pole. Given that we're in the police training academy, right? I just, as I was sitting here, I was wondering, what the heck are they for? I guess it's because the room divides, right? Oh, yeah, there it is. It's that big thing there. But I guess because I'm being filmed, I can't, like, be standing in front of the poles either, right? So I'll try to stay where I am and look at you all from over there. Anyway, a pleasure to be here. I'm from New York. I'm a native New Yorker, but I've spent my whole career working in child welfare, actually. On January 24th, it will be 40 years that I have worked in child welfare. Thank you. And for the most part, they have been 40 great years. I mean, I've really enjoyed what I've done. I love child welfare. I don't regret for one second doing it. I didn't think when I started that I would do it. I was 18 years old and worked in a cottage for what we called in those days the baby boys, you know, 6 to 13-year-old children who lived in a cottage that was about as big as this stage. And I'm not exaggerating, a little bit bigger maybe, but, you know, 15 kids, one 18-year-old taking care of all these 15 kids for sometimes, you know, 48 hours straight. You wouldn't be able to do that anymore. And also, you didn't get paid when you slept in, which I always thought was really interesting, you know. They would say, well, you're supposed to be sleeping. Yeah, but I get woken up 1,000 times a night by, you know, six-year-olds who are wet in the bed and crying and, you know, doing all kinds of things. But that's where I started my career, and I really have done many things in that career since then. My most recent thing, besides teaching at the Hunter College School of Social Work, where I'm a professor, and my expertise is child welfare, not surprisingly, I ran the National Center for Foster Care and Permanency Planning. It had many different names: the National Resource Center for Family Centered Practice and Permanency Planning, the National Resource Center for Family, I don't even remember the last iteration of it, and they stopped funding us last year. I'm sorry that George Shelton left, because it was probably under his administration that they stopped funding us, and I wanted to give him a word that what they funded currently ain't so hot. I wouldn't have been that impolite, but we did lots of work for 13 years in running around the country, and I worked with Juliana and folks here in Illinois, but working with lots of states and thinking about what would make for better permanency outcomes for young people. And I want to give you a couple of thoughts before I dive into this PowerPoint. We have some good time together, so I don't have to rush, you know, and I'm a New Yorker, so I kind of talk fast, but I'll try to slow it down. I just want to give you a little context of who I am, because I think that makes a big difference in terms of kind of my thoughts behind it. In addition to working for 40 years in the field, I'm the adoptive parent of three young people who are not so young anymore. My daughter Leslie is 47, my son Ian is 26, and Travis is 23. And Travis just told us about 2 weeks ago that his girlfriend, who he's been with for several years, is having a baby, so I guess I'll be a grandfather soon. Which I think I'm way too young for, but, you know, I'm sure you all thought that too when you became grandparents, right? But I think that's important, because I really always believe, and my parents were foster parents also, because I asked them to be. And so we had this history of kind of being connected on multiple levels to children and families, not just professionally, but also in a very personal way. Leslie, who is 47, was my child when I first met her at 9 at St. Agatha's Home in Nanuet, New York, and she was this very odd, developmentally disabled kid who no one thought could live with a family. And she wound up coming to live with me as a foster child when she was 16, and stayed with me pretty much all her life, doing many things, wonderful things, proving a lot of people wrong. And then when she was 37 one day, she said, Gary, I would like you to adopt me. And I said, sure, I'm happy to. And when she came to live with me as a foster child when she was 16 or 17, in those days we didn't talk about adopting older young people. It was like, oh, they don't really want to be adopted. And I had asked several times, do you want to be adopted? And Leslie is black, and she would say, Gary, you're black and I am white. You cannot be my father. And I'd say, well, I could, but yeah, those things are not going to change. So, you know, but so I thought we had had the conversation until she announced one day in front of about 500 people at a conference that she wanted to be adopted. And when they asked her, why didn't Gary ever adopt you? She said, because Gary Mallon just never wanted to adopt me. And I said, that's not true. And I also thought I would never be funded again for the rest of my life, which might have been a good thing. But the issue was is that she had thought about it for a long time. And so we did. We did an adult adoption when she was 37 years old. And when she was 37, I adopted her, even though I had thought she was my daughter all along. And one of the funny things she said to me in the elevator was, she said, Gary, you know that the judge told me that now that I am legally your daughter, when you die, I will inherit all of your money. That was the real thought behind it. She calls me every single day, every day, no matter where I am. And if she can't find me, she calls me repeatedly. And I'll sometimes say, look, if I'm not calling you back, I'm really busy. I'll call you when I can. But she insists she needs to be connected. And I think that that's a really kind of interesting story, right? Because we think that young people in foster care grow up and leave at 18 or 21, and that's it. They're independent living, boom, they're gone, and hooray, success. And the real deal is, unless they're anchored to a family, whether it's their own birth family or other families, they are not successful, and they're like a boat that's floating out there in the ocean without an anchor. That's always my little visual of them. And they literally are. They kind of float, they bump, they go out to sea too far, they get lost, sometimes they sink, they take on water. I mean, you can use a lot of metaphors, and that's what they look like. And even boys who are kids that were in my group homes that I ran many years after, who are now in their 30s and 40s, will email me, or they're my friends on Facebook, thank God for Facebook, and they will say things to me like, I really, really wish I had been adopted. I really, really wished you had found me a family. I'm like, yeah, I do too, and I feel terrible that at 36 you're still saying that, right? But they are, right? I had one kid who wrote me this beautiful text a couple of weeks ago, and I said to him, how old are you, Mauricio? 46. And he said, so he left my program when he was 21. So all those years later, he's still saying, what you did, it always makes me feel a little choked up, sorry. I didn't realize that that would happen like in 5 minutes of talking. But that what you guys did for me was what my family needed to do and didn't do. And I still remember that 25 years later. He's 46 years old, right? I mean, that to me was really, that's the best thing that any kid can tell you. Not that you want to hear that, because you shouldn't be doing this to get that, but and we almost never do, and that's why I said thank God for Facebook, right? Because at least we hear a little feedback. They used to just kind of disappear, right? You never knew really what happened to them, and you hope they did well. And this particular kid was a challenging young person. I mean, he was not your, you know, brilliant, bright, shining star. But the fact that he still feels that connection is really, really meaningful. And I just want to say another couple of things, too. I think that one of the things that we do in this field is we're always so into, you know, what's cutting edge, right? And we're always talking about, like, you know, meeting the cutting edge. And we're so into the cutting edge that we forget the real core things of what we're supposed to do. And I think this, remember, I don't know if you do, you know, this whole not evidence-based practice, but it's connected to that, where, you know, you're really looking at change. And they talk about being nimble to change, right? Being nimble about it. And I'm, to be honest with you, I'm sick of hearing it. But my thing is, because we become so nimble that we stand for nothing, right? We're so, my mother used to say, you know, I'll wag your bush and you wag mine. You know, we float back and forth so much that we don't stand for anything anymore. And I think what's happened is when we talk about instability with children, we've also created unstable systems, right? So if you're a worker in this system, and I'm not criticizing your system, I'm just kind of reflecting, and you know, I'm here today and I'll be gone tomorrow, so take it or leave it. But the idea of, you know, we've created these systems which were well-intentioned, frequently by folks who are appointees, some of whom know a lot about child welfare, some of whom know nothing. Okay, let's be real, right? And they come and they go, and I know you've had a lot of directors and you've had a lot of commissioners, and that's instability. So we've paralleled what we're doing in the system. So it's no shock that permanency is off, because we've paralleled that in our own system, right? And I think that that needs to be said, and I think you need to really think about, what does that mean? You know, what does it mean for the caseworker who's working there where there's instability? What does it mean for the supervisor? What does it mean for the manager? What does it mean for the assistant director? We've had all this instability. Anytime a new person comes along, it's like, oh crap, what are they gonna do? right? What kind of thing is she gonna change now? Oh God, you know, he's coming along here and now he's dealing with Casey and everybody else and they're bringing all these new ideas in here and what's gonna happen now? And it becomes the issue du jour of child welfare, right? So I wanted to say that because I think kind of in some ways that's where we're at. This idea of safety, permanency, and well-being, it's the mantra, the trinity of child welfare, right? We're good on safety, why? Because it's the worst possible outcome, right? A kid gets killed, a kid gets beat, they're known to our system, what happens? It's in the newspaper, it's on TV, everybody's running for cover, people are panicked about their job, supervisors are panicked about the notes that they superficially read because they're too busy, right? Managers are worried that, oh my gosh, you know, it was in my unit, what's gonna happen, how's that gonna reflect on me? That's the reality, right? But we got better on safety because there's an intense pressure about safety, right? In New York City, you know what they used to do? They would change the name of the agency every time something bad happened, right? When I first started, it was BCW, Bureau of Child Welfare. Then overnight, new logo, it was Special Services for Children. Then a few years later, overnight, Child Welfare Administration. Overnight became Administration of Children's Services. And it was like, wow, how'd that happen? Like, you know, what happened? It just changed because they wanted to kind of brand themselves new. And again, that's an important thing to do when you're in politics, and it's an important thing to do when you're running, you know, a statewide system, but it also is a way of deflecting, like, what happened, right? So I don't know if you've all done that here, but in New York, that's what I remember doing all the time. The other deal is the well-being piece, right? You know, we got very heavy into well-being in the last couple of years. Not that that's a problem. Well-being is important. Looking at protective factors that keep young people and families nurtured and safe, great thing. But I remember hearing, we don't need to work on permanency. Well-being is what we should be working on. So again, this new idea, this came from the federal government, a new idea from one of your former colleagues, you know, that it became a focus so heavily on well-being that permanency got kicked to the curb. So I remember thinking, I can't believe that they're saying this, because at some point, someone's gonna start looking at timeliness to permanency and say, oh wow, what happened? Well, we were told that well-being was the thing to do, and safety was the thing to do. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh crap, and we forgot about well-being. I mean, forgot about permanency. And I know I'm being superficial, I'm kind of being sarcastic about it, but I think there's a little bit of truth to it too, right? There's a little bit of, you know, hey, what about focusing on these other three variables that we really need to look at? I think if you're really gonna focus on having permanency that works, and I know that you're at a new point where you're thinking about that, you need to have good policies that are well thought out and well written and real, right? You ever read the policy manual? You know, there's things in there from 1957, and then there's things that you wrote yesterday, right? And believe me, I know how difficult it is to write policy and looking at it. But you need good policies. You need good training that supports the policies. And the poor training people are always kicked to the curb, right? These glasses are filthy. This idea that, you know, anytime a new initiative comes, they've got to train everybody. Who's here from training? Okay, so you know what I'm talking about, right? Is that all of a sudden, it's like, well, training, develop a new curriculum on that stuff overnight, okay? Better get that going, you know, we have a new policy here, you know, and the policy better match the training or you're in trouble, because that's what has to happen. And it then should flow to be good practice, right? And then overarching all of that or surrounding all of that needs to be good supervision. How many of you are supervisors? Right? Difficult, challenging work, right? Very difficult, very challenging, very kind of high profile. But all of these things, the policies, the training, the practice, fall flat unless you have good supervision. So like, what's your model of supervision? Mm-hmm. Right. So if you're looking at a practice model that talks about permanency, then we also need to look at a supervision model that looks at permanency. Supporting permanency. Because I'll tell you a couple of little things that I've seen. Especially I did a lot of work around older adolescent adoption. I'd have supervisors tell new workers, don't bother getting that 17-year-old adopted. He don't need to be adopted. Work on the babies. When the worker had just gone to a training that talked about youth permanency and the importance of getting older adolescents adopted. So the young new worker is challenging the supervisor to say, gee, but I just went to a training where they told me that it's really possible. Don't be listening to that stuff. Here's what really happens. So I think, and of course, that's the reality of the field. I'm not bashing the supervisor. It's like what a supervisor is thinking, like we need to move this along, we need to do this. And I think that we really need to think about what messages we're giving out in that area as well, okay? Those are just my initial thoughts. Okay, so what I was sitting there listening and thinking, there were a few other things that I wanted to make sure I got to, because I have a whole big PowerPoint here for you and a couple of little. All right, so a good little way to kind of get people thinking, right? I remember one time giving a talk like this, and this man in the audience raised his hand and said, you know, you're asking us to do an awful lot. And I said, do you have a child? And he said, yes, I do. I said, would you do what I'm asking you to do for your own child? And he said, of course. And I said, well, that's what we're asking you to do, right? So how many of you are parents? Right? And it's the hardest job you've ever had, right?
Yes.
Believe me, I know. It is not easy. I have three dogs now. It's easy. Three teenagers, three young people is a lot of work. Grew up wonderful, but just real challenging. And I think there are, and you know, our previous speaker who said, you know, she has kids who are older and they call her all the time. I mean, that it never, people, the fantasy is it ends at 21. It doesn't. They're living with you at 30. If they have stuff in your house still, they still think they can move back at any time. So, you know, you need to downsize quickly, get a small place, rent them some storage space so they can put their stuff there, you know, and let them, it's even okay if you pay for it, right? So the idea is get them situated, but, you know, keep emotionally connected, right? So it never ends. So we're gonna talk about a few things that, you know, I wanna kind of get us thinking about multiple things at the same time. And I'm gonna talk about more about practice-oriented things that I think can challenge us to think more about permanency. And maybe kind of thinking a little out of the box, how do we think differently about permanency? And kind of looking at the various kind of pathways to permanency. So you see these here, these are like the major federal changes that have happened. In 1980, this Child Adoption Assistance and Child Welfare Reform Act, that was the first time permanency got talked about in a legal way. And I remember working in child welfare at that time, and all of a sudden things changed dramatically. Because when I worked in child welfare, initially kids came into care at 6 and they stayed till they were 18 or 19 and they never left. And no one really tried to reunify them. It was just kind of, the assumption was you stayed until you were 18 and good luck. We, you know, don't make us embarrassed about your life. Do well when they left. We didn't do any independent living or anything. It was just they left. So that was the first time. The signing of the Adoption and Safe Families Act in 1997 by President Clinton changed that law dramatically because it put the onus of responsibility on the state, and it said that if you don't reunify children in 15 or less, 22 months, we will eventually, they haven't done it yet, stop your 4E funding, which means there's a penalty for not achieving permanency. Now, they've never really done that, but they're very close to, in some states, kind of making that determination. That was supported by, I'm going to skip Chafee for a second, the CFSR accountability system, which was also part of the signing of ASFA, because it was the system that came out and looked at states and talked to states, and they've changed that many times, and they've looked at permanency thresholds, and they've looked at safety thresholds, and they've really kind of monitored, and I'm a big believer that the CFSR really did help improve things, but only one way. If the state kept doing what they were doing to prepare for the CFSR throughout the time and kind of instituted that, it helped. If it was like, you know, they got ready to, they cleaned up the house before the company came, and then as soon as the company left, it went back to looking like it looked, then it really doesn't work, right? And some states did that, and some states really focused on keeping it going and really thinking about what are continuous quality improvements that the system needs to make for children, youth, and families. The signing of the Chafee legislation in 1999, which I always tell this story because I feel like I'm part of that story in some very small way, is a young man named Alfred Perez was on an airplane coming from California to DC, and Hillary Clinton happened to be on the plane, as she was the first lady at the time, and he said to her, I want to talk to you. I grew up in foster care, and I'm really concerned that, you know, all of the things that come in out of legislation are about younger children, not older kids, and kids like me still need a lot of help. And he gave her this book to read. And she read it, and she continued to have some conversation with him, and she went back to the White House and asked them to include about $11 million into the budget for older adolescents, which, you know, is like a quarter, right? But they did, and there was a big hoo-ha at the White House, and everybody was there, and it was a big deal. And then they started putting into action this legislation that they wanted to in every state, which was more money, and it was sponsored by John Chafee from Rhode Island, and Nancy Johnson from Connecticut. It was bipartisan support. One was Republican, one was Democrat. And they instituted this, they introduced this bill, and it was about older adolescents and giving money and really thinking about it. And the hearings started going really bad because there was no evidence. There was no data. And they kept saying, how do you know this is the case? Nothing, nothing, nothing. And guess what? A terrible thing happened. John Chafee died from a heart attack in the middle of all this, very unexpectedly. And after his funeral, the First Lady went back to the House and said, wouldn't it be a wonderful honor if we renamed this legislation the John Chafee Foster Care to Independence Act in honor of our colleague who just passed, and they unanimously passed it, which is politics, right? It was a good politics in a way, but it was gonna be completely abolished, and yet, you know, because of John Chafee's death, they kept it. And that's been useful, helpful, not about permanency though. It's about going to school, it's about education, which is where it fell short, right? Didn't say anything about permanency. And then the Bushes came along and we have the focus on permanency for older youth, and they had their own shtick on adoption and foster care, and part of it was very personal. They had sought to adopt children before they had their own twins, and they had a lot of ideas about what adoption should look like, and they were very interested and had been kind of talked to about older adolescent adoption, and they focused on that and they gave money, and that was great. It was really some wonderful publications and some wonderful research came out of older adolescent adoption kind of focus. And then the last one, which is probably, besides MEPA, one of the most convoluted pieces of legislation that ever got passed, was Fostering Connections, which is in 2008. It's really like eight different laws smushed into one. And there's one piece in there about older adolescents. And there are many things about adoption and tribal agreements and training and kinship care and defining kinship care and guardianship, kin gap, all that stuff. Good stuff, but it's like a huge piece of legislation. And the adolescent piece, again, missed the mark. It's all about a 90-day discharge plan before the kid leaves. And it's like, are you kidding? 90 days before they leave, you're going to start making a plan? Way too late. Way too late. And how ridiculous that you even think that because you put it on paper, it's going to happen, right? So there was a big problem about that legislation from that perspective. But I think it's important to know that from a permanency perspective, these first two are really this one's the law of the land now. And it really kind of reinvigorated a conversation about permanency. I looked at AFCAR's data, which is the Adoption and Foster Care Analysis and Reporting System. And again, I always look at it just when I do a presentation because I think, you know, regular folks who are doing this work look at what's going on in Illinois, but you might not look at what's happening nationally, and sometimes I think it's shocking. So these AFGARs 22, which are collected every year from all the states, as of July 2015, we see that 415,129 young people are in care. That's gone up. It was 402, and before that it was 399, and it's very interesting, and there's no analysis from the government on why. But it's going up, and that's not a very good sign, right? About 108,000 children are free and waiting to be adopted in the United States. That's huge, right? And children wait about almost 3 years to be adopted. Okay, so permanency and timeliness to adoption is a huge area as well. I left in Louisiana stat. I'll have to ask you guys, but 50,000 are adopted nationally, almost 51, and I don't know what your stat is, and I didn't ask for it, for how many kids are adopted in Illinois every year. I have some Illinois-specific stats in the next slide. I always think this is an important conversation, too, about young people of color, because 56% of the children nationally are young people of color, and how that data is teased out is, about 24% of them are African American kids, 22% are Latino children, and then the remainder are children who are two or more races or children who are Asian, Pacific Islanders, very small populations. But when you cluster it together, about 56% of kids are kids of color. Most concerning is 24% are African American young people in the system, which is disproportionately represented for kids of color. And I'm always concerned about that because I always think, you know, we get very into, you know, timeliness to permanency and stuff about safety and stuff about well-being. And I always wondered why when we did CFSR, nobody ever took on race and ethnicity and said, well, let's think about what a good kind of threshold for that would be, or what would be a penalty for states who really don't address that issue. Not that we need any more penalties, but I think this is an important issue. I mean, and in some cases, it almost reflects what we see with men of color who are in prison, right? We see huge percentages in juvenile detention and in adult detention of men of color in prison. And what about the people who are not of color? Where are they if they do bad things, right? And I think in foster care, I know from my own perspective with my own son, he got arrested for doing scratch feeding, right? We go to court and, you know, he gets a little slap in the hand because he had a bunch of parents there. And he wound up having to clean the subways with somebody who thought he was cute and took him Christmas shopping for her nephew. And I thought, this is terrible. Your butt should have been like in subway tracks with rats cleaning, not like going shopping. You know, because he was cute and because, you know, he kind of got over. He's Latino. But, you know, there was this other kind of thing of, you know, some kids get more serious punishments than others. In a lot of states, especially in South Dakota, where 3% of the population identifies as Indian, 63% of the kids are Indian. That's huge. And South Dakota denies that's a problem. I actually got a letter from their governor because I was criticizing them. And he was very annoyed that I was criticizing them. And I said, I'm sorry, that's the data. No, we've done many things, they've corrected it, it's wrong. Well, I went to a meeting in South Dakota and the Indian folks would not even sit at the same table as the government people. They wouldn't even eat lunch in the same restaurant. I mean, there's a real problem historically. North Dakota, completely different. Those folks have done some really wonderful tribal agreements, totally different experience, but South Dakota has some serious problems. These are our traditional pathways to permanency, right? Return to parent, which we call reunification, which is, we always say there is no preferred permanency, but that's not really true. It's return to parent. I remember as a childcare worker, you know, we would focus on children shouldn't remain in care longer than they needed to because we really wanted to reunify them with their parent when it was safely possible to do that. So, and it is always put first. And adoption is always second, which I always think is interesting because adoption is not the most common permanency pathway after reunification. Actually, permanent placement with a fit and willing relative is. So we'll talk about that in a minute. Legal guardianship, real small, that's a problem. And I think, you know, we've done things around, but Mark Testa has done some phenomenal work around legal guardianship and subsidized guardianship. And yet it's still a really small piece of the permanency puzzle. And we sometimes, I hear lawyers especially, and judges sometimes saying, well, it's not a very durable form of permanency. And it's like, and it isn't, but it's not designed to be. It's designed to be reviewed every 6 months, as is every permanency plan, right? But yet somehow guardianship is a thing that we don't see as having some durability. So I think it opens us up to thinking more about guardianship in different ways. Permanent placement with fit and willing relatives, again, according to ASFA, what we were seeing with mostly grandparents, right, and mostly grandmothers, mostly, is, you know, folks at a certain point, a la ASFA, saying this, the rights of that parent need to be terminated, who is your child usually, and you need to become the adopted parent. That's changing a bit, right? That's the way the law was originally written. Many judges and legal folks said, you know what? This grandmother's already related to these kids. Now I have to like terminate her daughter's rights to make her a permanent and legal I don't know if that's a good thing. And judges started changing that. And I think one of the good things about fostering connections is we were able to then think about how we could do that a little differently. So the whole kin gap piece of really thinking about keeping children with fit and willing relatives that were making permanent plans was important. And we're gonna talk about guardianship as a permanency pathway, kinship as a permanency pathway, because again, I think, well, with your numbers, that's the largest group, right? And I think there are things about kinship that we need to think about with respect to permanency differently. And then the worst of all is APLA. Another plan, permanent living arrangement. Lots of states call it different things, right? I don't know what you call it here. Do you call it APLA? PPA, huh?
Long-term foster.
Long-term, which was outlawed during during ASPA, but some people still use it, and actually the AFGAR statistics still count long-term foster care, but it's abysmal. It's the worst of all the permanency pathways. It means no plan. It means we have no friggin' idea what we're gonna do with you when you leave. We hope something works out. Really, it does, right? We're gonna send you to the military and that'll work out, right? Or you're gonna go to Job Corps and, you know, you'll get a skill, good, you know. Or you're gonna be reunited by yourself with that family we've been telling you for 20 years you can't live with. That's what happens a lot, right? Or you go couch surfing with friends, which never lasts, right? People are very nice in the beginning and then they want you off their couch, right? So APLA is a horrible permanency pathway. And I've heard people say, yeah, but for very disabled kids, it's really good. No, it's not. It's a horrible permanency pathway. And of course, legally, we can use it, and we do. And the idea is, how do you keep it really small, right? And it, again, is a permanency option that you have to look at every 6 months. One of the things that happened, again, I don't always use New York as a good example, but in this case, they were. We used to use a PPG, permanency planning goal, of 03 for every teenager. Every teenager had an 03 goal, which was APLA, really. We didn't know that. We didn't even know what APLA was, but it was 03 PPG, and it meant independent living, okay? And all these boys and girls were going on to independent living. They're gonna live independently, get their own crib and live and be cool, and you know, everything was gonna be great. We're gonna make them go through the life skills training, and that was the end of it. They were gonna be fine. Big fantasy, right? And I think the issue was is that, you know, those young people really got shortchanged because we didn't look at it every 6 months. So what happened was is that they in a permanency hearing made you justify every 6 months, which is not a bad idea. How come not reunification? How come not guardianship? How come not long-term care with a fit and willing relative? How come not adoption? Every 6 months, you needed to look at that. And it forced people to say things differently. And I know I ran a group home for teenage boys. They were 25 boys between the ages of 16 and 21. And I remember going to meetings and hearing, oh, these kids want to be adopted, and thinking to myself, to be really honest with you, yeah, sure. Because I was running a group home for boys and they seemed pretty happy there. You know, and they kind of did a lot, they did whatever they felt like doing. That was why they were happy, living in a group home, which was not a good thing. It was a good group home, but there were times when, you know, it's like, who's really in charge here, the kids or us? And they were teenage kids, so you know how they are. But I remember going home one day after going to a meeting and saying, let me just ask you all a question. If I could find you a family tomorrow, like an adopted family who would adopt you and make you part of their family and love you, would you want that? And they were like, yeah, who wouldn't want a family? And I was really shocked by that. I was really shocked because I thought they wanted their own crib, you know? But in reality, they almost all of them, about 50% of them, said they really wanted a family that would care for them. And I see that now with these Facebook kids, right? They will email me and I'll say, what are you doing? Oh, I'm living with a friend, you know, I'm 36. I'm working, yeah. You know, you seeing anybody? No, not really. You ever keep in touch with your mother? No, I don't deal with her at all. You know, who else is in your life? And they're like, they're floating. And I think, wow, we really missed the opportunity, right? And because we couldn't anchor them at a point in their life when they probably really needed to be anchored, they've just kind of floated out there, right? I mean, my daughter Leslie, one of the reasons she calls me every night is I'm the anchor, right? She knows that no matter where I am, I'm gonna stop what I'm doing, we're gonna talk, I ask her the same questions. How's your day? What'd you do in school? What'd you eat for dinner? What are you doing tomorrow? You know. Sometimes she'll tell me something, whenever she starts the conversation off with, I have something really bad to tell you. I used to be like, when she was younger, hold my breath thinking, please God, don't make this that I'm having a baby. It never was, thank God. But I always would say that secret prayer, please God, don't make her have a baby. I do not want to raise that baby. And we had many talks about that, you know. And I'd say to her, suppose you get pregnant, what would you do? I would have that baby, Gary, because I would want a baby. I'd say, okay. And what would you do if that baby was crying all night long till 4 o'clock in the morning? He said, I would probably slap it. I was like, okay, then that's why you shouldn't have a baby. Because that would be really bad. And then that baby would go into foster care. Remember what it was like living in foster care? Yes, I would never want my child to live in foster care. Okay, well, that's probably what would happen. It was good birth control for a while. She's 47 now, so hopefully to God, you know, that's over. You never know. But that idea of being an anchor for somebody is important. And I'm not, and you know what, in no way am I using those examples to say, oh, I'm so great. I'm not. I'm as flawed as a parent as any of you are, you know, and was then and now, and, you know, it's just not easy. But I think there are things that are simple things that some of us really need to think about doing. And I think that we, again, it's a little bit out of the box, but I think that you have to kind of think, well, what would it look like if we did something that was a little bit out of the box? So let's take a look at some of these. These are national placement settings. You see that the most common one is non-relative foster care, which is not the case for you guys, but is nationally the case, 48%. 8% of kids are in group homes, 10 in institutions. SILPs are supervised independent living apartments for older kids. I think those are phenomenal programs. I know they're congregate care, they're considered congregate care, but they're great programs for teaching young people about living somewhat independently with supervision. Runaway and homeless youth and child discharge to families. But you'll see a display there. And then here are, according to your data, as of the 27th, 16,147 kids were in placement in Illinois. And I just took ones that were the highest. Okay, there's a sheet with many different variables that Rachel gave me, but I wanted to just reflect on some of them. So home with relative, 37.5%. That's where most of the young people in your system are. Foster home and private agency, almost 17%. Specialized foster home, 13%. Would specialized foster home be kids with developmental disabilities and physical disabilities or something else?
Broad.
Okay, broad, like a whole bunch of different, whatever we call specialized, okay. Institutional private, about 6%. Foster home adoption, almost 5%. Foster home boarding, about 5%. Transitional living, 2.4. Independent living, sorry, I messed up the thing there, about 2%. Group home, very small, which I was impressed by, 1.3. You could probably think these last couple these last three are pretty much teenagers, right? So again, you know, not a huge number, and actually this is a very positive number, but then how do we turn that positive number into, you know, really moving to permanency, right? Because once kids are in relative care, you know, is that permanent enough? You know, and how do we think about that? And I want to also talk at some point about the issue of foster parents who love our kids and keep our kids but won't become their legal parent. So therefore, they remain in long-term foster care in a foster home, and they promise that they would never do anything that would change that, and yet there's variables that they don't have any control over, right? So I do want to talk about that a little bit, because I think we are part of that problem too, for a lot of different reasons. You know, we're part of it because we allow it to happen, and because we also think, well, they're good people, they would never do anything bad for that kid. So I think, you know, we got to think about that a little bit more. So these are some data from this. And I'm happy to give Rachel this PowerPoint afterwards. Of course, you know, I was working on it until, you know, like 7 o'clock this morning. So, you know, I didn't give it to her ahead of time, but I'm happy to give it to her right after this, and she can email it to you, and you can do whatever you want with it. Okay, good. Okay, these are back to kind of national stats. I just want to give you an idea about when you look at permanency pathways, more or less, as a plan, like a permanency planning goal versus the achievement of that goal, again, nationally, the most common plan, 55%, is reunification. The most commonly achieved goal is also reunification. So therefore, I think we spend an awful lot of time, you know, like in 2 days it's adoption, you know, National Adoption Month, right? Great. What about National Reunification Month? They're trying to do that, right? It hasn't kicked off. But I mean, the idea of reunification, and I'm going to talk about each specific permanency pathway specifically in a minute, is interesting because reunification, although we're very excited about it, makes us very nervous, right? And I think part of it is that. But it still is the most commonly achieved goal. And I think for younger kids and for older kids, it looks different, right? For younger kids, there's a heavy duty focus on safety. Is the home safe enough? Are the conditions with which the child entered the placement now ameliorated to the extent that they can safely be home with some support or not? And I think for older adolescents, it's a little bit different. Not that it can't be safe, but safety looks different for a big 6'4", 16-year-old girl. I always say boy, so I'll say girl. It could be a big 6'4" girl, right? So it's different. You know, that child can be protected in different ways, or they're old enough, you know, not to put them in a dangerous situation. And the reality about reunification, I think, also kind of concerns us is that families can and do change, right? And that's about family, right? That's about looking at our families and saying, you know, think about the way we talk about them, right? Think about the way we talk about them when they're not in the room, and think about the way we talk about them when they are in the room. A little different. Shouldn't be, but, and it is. A little bit different, right? I always say to folks, you know, think about your own family, right? Because my mother used to say, good-heartedly, whenever I had a bad problem with one of my kids, well, Gary, you know, you don't know where they come from. You know. They could be a murderer. I'd say, you know, he's four, Ma. I don't think he's going to murder us. We're just kind of running through a rough patch. You just don't know where they came from, you know. And I would say, like, our family was so wonderful. Like, think about your own family, Ma, you know. They weren't so wonderful. So I always say to people, you know, think about your own family. Did you ever have somebody in your family who was an alcoholic and quit drinking? Right? Sometimes it took two or three times. You ever have somebody in your family who went to jail? And now they're out. And they're doing okay. Did you ever yourself smoke cigarettes? How many times did you try to quit? How many people here ever smoked? How many of you quit? How many of you quit multiple times? How many of you still smoke? Okay. That number's getting really small. See, if that was permanency, we'd be in a good place. But it is getting smaller. And today I saw people outside smoking. It was cold, and it was like punishment, right? They were all out there smoking and freezing. But it used to be, when I went to college, the professor smoked. Remember? They'd be smoking in the classroom. We'd all be smoking. There were ashes everywhere. You know, remember when you were in the office, there were ashes all over the typewriter and everything, and people would be smoking. It was like, but the good old days, right? But the issue is, even though it's difficult, people can make changes. And I think with families, it's similar. Even though there are really challenging things that families do, families can and do change. And some of our families that we see have some pretty serious problems, right? My School of Social Work moved from a very she-she Park Avenue 79th Street location to up in East Harlem 3 years ago. Great thing for us to do. And not that those she-she people on 79th Street didn't have problems, but we didn't see them. They were in the Park Avenue apartments, whatever they were doing there. I'll tell you one funny story. One day I'm walking by this Park Avenue apartment, and I see this woman kind of huddled in the doorway, and she is completely bruised. And I right away, as a social worker, start thinking, wow, you know, I wonder what happened to her. I like wonder why she's standing in that doorway. I wonder if she got beat up by her husband or her boyfriend or something. And then my brain started thinking about all these things, and I almost was like, you know, kind of say, you know, you okay? Because she looked horrible. And then her limousine pulled up. And then the doorman escorted her into the limo. And then I realized, oh, she's going to the plastic surgeon to have the facelift inspected, right? And it was like, wow, the context of where people were at was very different. Because up in East Harlem, if that was the case, she would probably not be going to the plastic surgeon, right? So there was something about kind of the environment and where people live. And the reason I'm using East Harlem as a great example is because it's like really happening on the street, right? And you know, if you live in a neighborhood where people are out in the street a lot, right, you hear all kinds of conversation on the cell phone, right? Oh, and then he did this to me, and you know, and I told him this, and you know, then he tried to take my money, and you know, there's like a big conversation going on in the street. And I always think, okay, how, if that person's a parent, and sometimes I see them with their children, I start thinking, what's going on with that person and their child? Right? I try not, you know, people say, oh, don't be judgmental. But I don't even know them, right? I'm just walking down the street. So I'm just kind of as an exercise as a social worker thinking, what's going on here, right? And we, you know, I guess you all have subway systems in Chicago too, but when you're on the subway also, things play out on the subway. So you're part of it whether you want to be part of it or not. So you're kind of watching mothers with kids. And nowadays, I was just teaching a class in development. And I said, one of the developmental milestones should be, does the child know how to use the iPhone? Because that's what every parent does on the subway. This 18-month-old is fussing, and all of a sudden the parent's like, here. And the kid's like, knowing immediately. 18 months old, they're like, you know, they have their own apps on there. So There's something about the ability to observe people in public. I'll tell you one other story that I saw one day on the street. And I'm always observing these things. I saw a young mother with somebody who's maybe her boyfriend, and she had a child who I think was her son, and the kid was on the bicycle, a little bicycle. And the kid went a little bit too far and went in the street with the bicycle. And the mother was mad, as she should have been, right? Because you shouldn't go in the street with your bicycle. But when she approached the kid, he went like this. And I thought, you know, and he kept saying, mommy, don't hit me. And I thought, she's in a very public place, and she was not holding back, and she was giving it to him verbally, not physically. But it made me think, wow, I wonder, you know, first of all, there's a couple things going on there, right? She's stressed out, right? Because, you know, her kid went in the street. That's stressful. It makes you upset. You're worried. You want to protect your child. But there was another element that I was kind of observing around, you know, how quick to being violent with that kid was she, right? And maybe that's what happened when she was growing up, right? I don't know what happened to me. I mean, my mother was not one of these timeout people. It was like, you know, you did something, whack, you know. You know, I would be one of those kids that was like pulling back, but I was almost perfect though, so I never really got hit. But that idea of the stress of families that we see, it plays itself out in really visible ways. So when I compare it to my own experience, it might be similar or different. And I think as workers, we do that all the time, right? You enter someone's home and it's like, oof, my house was not like this, thank God. Or this is really different from what I grew up in. And maybe they look like you or they sound like you, but the experience of what they've been through has been different. And I think also what we don't see about our families or don't think about on enough of a basis is, you know, they didn't get to be like that one day. That's a big piece, you know? What? And that's part of that whole trauma stuff. That, you know, we're talking a lot about trauma, not why you behave in the way you're behaving. But what happened to you that makes you act like that? And again, it's not just semantics and it's not political correctness, but it really, when you pull back and you say to somebody, man, what happened to you in your lifetime that you're living like this, that you're parenting like this, you know, what stresses happened to you? And then people start talking to you. And it's not an easy fix. Right? So it's a longer term kind of thing. But I think it's part of what we need to be able to meet parents at that level. And it's part of what, if we can get them back to reunification, we have to work through a lot of that to get there. And this whole mess about, oh, we'll send them to parenting skills training. My God, right? Some of them need it. Some of them could teach it, right? But I mean, it's like a catch-all for everybody. Let's write that in the plan, parenting skills training. As if it's some magic, or you know, therapy. Oh, he needs to be in therapy, like it's magic. I mean, not saying that therapy's not good, not saying parenting skills are not good, but when it's the plan for everybody, it's probably not good, right? So reunification is important. Adoption, the plan was 25% and only 21% achieved adoption as a permanency goal. Relative care, nationally 3%, but in reality, 7%, so something's up there, right? It jumps up a couple points there, not usually, but you know, a few. Emancipation, which is again another one. This is another APLA kind of thing, right? 5%, 9%. Again, it jumps up 4 points, right? And I think for teenagers, again, permanency looks different. You can't just do a training on permanency for everybody and not really differentiate the permanency pathways and experiences for younger children versus older children. They're not the same at all. Younger children, you know, if they're in a home and you place them in a home and hopefully they stay in that home and they're free for adoption, they get adopted by the people who cared for them. Teenagers, they've been in 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 17 placements, right? They're living in a residential program, they're 17, you're now promising them another forever family and they're saying, bullshit, ain't no forever family for me. You know, that's nonsense. These people always tell me they're gonna find somebody, they always get rid of me. And if you ever really work with young people who grew up in care, the fear of being gotten rid of is very, very, very strong, right? Even my own daughter, who has been with me for years, will say, Gary, is there anything I can do that would make you throw me out of the family? I said, honey, you've done so many crazy things, you'd be thrown out long ago if there was something. And she said, how about if I killed one of your dogs? And I'd say, do you feel like killing one of my dogs? No, but I just wanna know, It's like, I would be really angry if you killed one of my dogs, but no, I wouldn't throw you out of the family. I would be very angry at you, and you know, we'd have a very big conversation, and I may not welcome you here for a while, but I'd probably still talk to you, you know? It's not like you could do anything, but that fear of being gotten rid of, right? It's almost like, you know, say you're in a relationship with somebody and you know it's unequal, right? Like you're at home and they work and they pay the bills and you're home and you try to do your thing and they kind of keep saying to you like, huh, you know, if you don't get it together here, I'm gonna get rid of you. It's very nerve-wracking, right? And I think what happens is that young people grow up feeling that for their whole lives. So there's always that feeling of fear about being gotten rid of because permanency was not achieved. And even when it is, in Leslie's case, I mean, it's achieved, but it's still that residual effect, the trauma of not having it for all those years stays with you. So emancipation's very concerning to me because I think it means that these kids are just going out, you know? And believe me, I know teenagers are not easy to care for. When I ran a group home for teenage boys, it was challenging. I love them, but I mean, you know, there were days when it was a nightmare. And they'd be walking out the door with their bag packed, like looking at you like, I'm leaving, I got my own place, and they'd be wanting you to beg them to stay. And part of you would be saying, I hope you go, because you're a big pain in the butt. And another part of you was saying, I know you'll be back tomorrow because you don't have nowhere to go and you don't have a job and you don't have a GED and, you know, how are you going to live? So, but that emancipation dream is the dream that all teenagers have, at least in America, right? If you live in Brazil or in a Latin country, you live at home with your family until you get married. And if you don't get married, you never leave home, right? It's just kind of a cultural phenomenon. And in many Middle Eastern countries as well. You just stay at home, you know, and your family takes care of you and, you know, it's like, it's not even seen as a bad thing. It's like, why would you leave your mother? You know, she's gonna be taking care of you. I mean, it's a completely different concept here in America, right? It's like, if you don't, you know, you're not together and out of house by 18, like, what's wrong with you? You know, like, you're moving back home after college, what's the matter with you, right? But yet we know many kids do. Because adolescence and that age of need stays longer and longer. It's expanded, right? My nephew is 29 years old. He still lives with my sister and her husband. I'm like, what's up with you? He's moved out 3 times and come back. And then my sister will tell me, oh, I iron his shirts and I buy his food. I said, no wonder why he's not leaving. He's never gonna leave. And he has a girlfriend and she lives at home with her family too and does the same thing with her. And I think, wow. I mean, again, times have changed. They're also only children. So, you know, there's a whole nother phenomenon about being a very beautiful golden child of the only child, right? Last one is guardianship, which again, 5% as a plan, 9% as a goal. Again, there's kind of an increase there, right? I mean, I think the biggest and most important one to look at is reunification, followed by adoption, which are probably the most dominant goals. I mean, besides relative care or achievement of goals. But again, just as an idea of kind of where you're at. I wanted to reflect back on these two slides that our previous speaker talked about because that's, you know, kind of our issue, right? Is the percentage of children who exited to permanency within the 12 and 24 months below the national average, okay? We know that Illinois' average is almost 17%, nationally it's about 36%, okay? To really pull that apart and decipher why, lots of reasons, right? The way I entitled this is that it's not so important about where we've been, it's where you want to go. So the reality is, if we know that to be the fact, at this point in time, how do we want to change that? How do we want to think about that? How do we want to move that number forward? Kids in care for long periods of time, again, this one really always concerns me because you look at congregate care, APLA, your oldest kids, 6%, right? That's a big number. Right, but it's a comparable number in foster care, right? And then in kinship care, it's much less, all right? But APLA is a really concerning goal, 2% in adoption. These are the older kids. And the younger kids, we're seeing, you know, some bigger numbers here around adoption from foster care age 0 to 12. I think it's just a graphic illustration of some of the things that we want to kind of keep in mind to remember and to think about as things we want to kind of see some change in. One of the really nice things when we were preparing for this day is that Rachel had told me they used the National Resource Center's definition of permanency, and I kept hoping it was the same one that I used, and it is pretty much, which is great. I think the one I have may have another sentence or two, but I just wanted to kind of start there before we kind of start looking at each of the, the permanency pathways and talking a little bit about them. So this it's a long definition, but I think when we were trying to think of what really permanency looked like, because it's such an amorphous term sometimes, especially for children, which we'll talk about later, and for families, but we wanted to really think about what does it really mean. So this is what we came up with. Is permanence is not a philosophical process, a plan, or a foster care placement. And a lot of times we think, well, the kid's in a permanent place, so that's permanency, right? It's not. Nor is it intended to be a family relationship that lasts only until the child or youth turns 18. And again, I hear a lot of people say, well, you know, we guarantee that this kid will have permanency until they're 18 because they're living with this family, and then after that, you know, maybe the family will allow them to continue to live with them, or maybe they won't because they're living in a foster family. And the idea is that's not permanency either. So, and it's beyond 18 because in reality, young people need a permanent lifetime connection for their lifetime, not just until they're 18. Permanence is about locating and supporting a lifetime family. And we've always really believed in this concept of, you know, the permanence is about a family, however you define family. And here's the best definition of family I've ever known. It was by Ann Hartman and Joan Laird. A family is a family when two or more people decide to call themselves a family. Real broad. Nothing about blood, nothing about marriage. It's about just when you call yourself family. For young people in out-of-home placement, planning for permanence should begin at entry into care, which is, again, kind of flies in the face of this 90-day discharge. It really needs to start from the very beginning. This kid enters the system. What's their permanency plan? What are we working towards from day one? Not 60, 90, 120 days into it. And it should be child or youth driven. I think when young people can be part of the planning, you know, this nothing about me without me is phenomenal, right? Especially for teenagers. Teenagers should not have people just plan for them. They need to be part of the plan. Younger children, of course, however developmentally you can have them be part of the plan is always useful, but you know, it's kind of ridiculous. You're not gonna engage a two-year-old in their own planning, right? But you know, developmentally, I think at points you need to think about to be family focused, to be culturally competent, continuous, and approached with a high degree of urgency. And that urgency is really critical. We're getting older and we're moving along, and a week for us is nothing. A week for a kid is a long time. A month for a kid is a really long time. So the idea of how do we approach it with thoughtful urgency. There was a guy named Kevin Campbell who did all this stuff on family finding. One of the things I liked about his perspective was he said, you know, when there's a disaster and the Red Cross comes to help the family in the disaster, they don't wait until the morning to call you. They call you right then. Now, not that you need to call people at 4 o'clock in the morning and say, hey, these three kids need a home and we've been identified as the aunt, so we need you to take them. But our urgency goes on for weeks and weeks sometimes, right? So we need to think of what does urgency really look like? Does it look like the next day? Does it look like within 24 hours? You know, of really thoughtful urgency. Child welfare agencies in partnership with the larger community have a moral and professional responsibility to find a permanent family relationship for each child and young person in foster care. And here's like a little, this is one of my dreams here. How many of you have ever worked at One Church, One Child? Right? Great program, fabulous program. Know what we need to say to them if we're working on adolescents? No more babies for you. We got 17, 18-year-olds who need family. So, I mean, again, from a youth perspective, and I know we're talking about all the young people in the system, not just young people who are teenagers, but I think we really need to pitch the ones who are neediest, the ones who we sometimes hear people say that are loneliest, right? And our younger children sometimes are able to hopefully find permanency more smoothly because, you know, they're in a home and those people are there and they become their family and first placement's the last placement. You know, it's another whole kind of mantra we talked about, right? Which hopefully we can achieve, you know. And I think that with older kids though, we don't have that luxury. You have to really say, what are the ways to get folks to think about these kids differently? I'll tell you one thing that I know is not your problem here, but it was interesting. And I was telling this to Rachel on the phone the other night. Is I worked with one state and we were talking about a case. And the case was a child who had been born to a mom who had a substance abuse problem. And the mom gave birth to the child in the hospital and left. and never connected with the child again, despite heroic efforts by the caseworkers. I mean, this one caseworker was telling me, I knocked on the window of the crack house where mom lived, and I'm like, how'd you know where she lived? Somebody in the neighborhood said she was there. I went there, I knocked on the window. I did talk to her through the window, but she wouldn't come out. She promised me she would come to court the next day. I really needed her to be there, but she didn't come. So I said, okay, so what's the plan for this kid? Well, he's been in the same foster home now for 15 months. And what's the plan? Reunification. What? Right? And I said that, what? And they said, and the supervisor said, we're all about family-centered practice here, so we can't terminate that family because we're about keeping families together. And I know this is not your problem, but I just thought it was a really bizarre way of thinking about family strengths and family support. And in reality, at 6 months, they should have been moving towards termination of parental rights because there had been absolutely no contact with this child and this mom, right? And that child should have been maintained in that home that had that baby from the minute that he or she was born. I don't remember if it was a boy or girl. But that idea of, you know, we get our messages mixed sometimes, right? It's like, oh, we're trying to preserve families, but we're allowing that kid to remain in care for 15 months? I mean, it's the whole life of that child. And in reality, we really were even violating the law by not moving towards permanency at 6 months. And I forgot if it's 6 or 9, but it was, you know, certainly not 15. And actually, I was in that state last week, and a lawyer came up to me and told me the same story. And I thought, so who told you that? Because I was hoping it wasn't from the same area. And it's somebody from another part of the state. And I said, wow, that's a big problem. If the message is that convoluted, then we need to have our permanency message be a lot more clear. Because children certainly shouldn't be remaining infants in a home for 15 months without moving towards permanency. Right? Either going back home to mom that we've worked with, or being permanently adopted in that family where they've lived for their entire time. Permanence should be bring physical, legal, and emotional safety and security within the context of a family relationship and allow multiple relationships with a variety of caring adults. I think especially for older kids, again, and for younger children, there are many people that are in their lives. The question that we frequently used to ask people is, what would it take for you to make a permanent commitment to this kid? That's a good question, right? So if the foster parents are saying, excuse me, you know, I got older kids and they don't really want me to adopt another one, and you know, inheritance stuff, you know, like they have billions of dollars. But families do that, right? It's like, you know, the older kids are saying, oh, you know, why are we taking another one in? And you know what happens then? But they're giving you this spiel, and you need to ask, what would it take for you to make a permanent commitment to that child, right? And I think similarly, with a guardian situation or with a mentoring kind of situation, I'll talk about why those are important resources as well in terms of permanency, because we don't always think about them, is sometimes they're pathways to permanency. They're not the direct line, but if you have a great mentor that works with a young person, perhaps at some point that mentor becomes a foster parent and then an adoptive parent. And part of that for older kids is when that kid thinks they're ready, which is, again, about engaging young people in the process. So a variety of caring adults is, I think, something that we should think about. Permanence is achieved with a family relationship, again, that offers safe, stable, committed parenting. We added unconditional love. The law does not say it needs to be unconditional love, but we thought that it was important. And lifelong support and a legal family membership status. And I think, you know, if you are a parent, you know that it takes a lot of unconditional love to continue to be a good parent, right? You know, they've wrecked your car, they vomited on your carpet, they had 12 people at the house when you told them not to, you know, they did horrible things in school, you've been called out of work now for 10 times, your boss is a child welfare person, but they're looking at you crooked, you know, which always is a problem in child welfare, right? You know, is that you still get that look, like, again, your crazy kid is doing something in school? But I think certainly unconditional love and legal family membership status is part of that, part of how do you ensure that young person that they are really going to be part of your family for the rest of their lives, that there's nothing that you could do, that they could do. I'll give you another little story that somebody told me one day, which was, I think, really interesting. This young child who was had diabetes was in a family, and he was not taking his insulin. And big problem with the family. And the family happened to be the family that won the Adopted Family of the Year award. And they did all the training for everybody, and they were stellar, adoptive parents. And they were so disturbed by this young child, who's like maybe about 12 or 13, who didn't take his medication, and so disturbed that they said to the agency, they were really sorry, but they felt that they could no longer care for him in their home. He was adopted too. And that the child had been told that, you know, his adoption and his relationship to his family was permanent, and that it was immutable, and that it was not something that could be changed. And yet, the family gave him back to the agency. So the kid was struggling with, how could that be? How could it be permanent? And the worker, who was really smart, said, oh, the kid was living in a group home. You have, you know, I'm thirsty. Can you get me some milk? And he said, sure, all right, and gave him a glass of milk. And the guy said, well, you know, do you have any chocolate syrup you can put in that milk? And he said, yeah, I do. And he squeezed in chocolate syrup and stirred it around, and he brought it to the guy, and the guy said, okay, now I want you to take the chocolate out of the milk. And he said, I can't do that. And he said, yeah, that's immutable. But what you had was not, unfortunately. It was a nice little metaphor for, you know, how do you take that out, right? How do you separate those two things? It's impossible to do, right? I mean, I'm sure chemically there's some way you could do it, but, you know, in a family, you can't do that. And for this kid, that made all the difference. Of course, that worker, who was a phenomenal person, wound up adopting that kid, and then it was an immutable situation because he had adopted several kids, and that was just part of, you know, their connection, I guess. But I just love that story because it really kind of, this idea of it's permanent, we found your lifetime families, what does that really mean? You know, and you know, we focus, you know, permanency, I read this somewhere one time, I don't remember where, but permanency in and of itself is not a panacea. Just because we've achieved permanency does not mean that everything's gonna be great, right? And it's one of the challenges as a foster and adoptive parent that we have, right? Is you've worked so hard to prove yourself worthy that when problems do happen, and they do, you're panicked about saying, I need help. Right? So, you know, the whole post-permanency services, that's another whole conference, right? That's next year's conference, Rachel. Post-permanency services, right? This whole idea of, like, what do we do to support families when they have achieved permanence is huge, right? Huge. When my child got arrested and you know, for scratch feedy, he said he had to go to therapy. That was the solution. And he would not go to a therapist unless he was black and he was cool. And I said, and a man. And I was like, oh, that's not even easy to find in New York City, right? And refusing to go. He had all these criteria of what he was going to do and not do. And actually, we found him a therapist who was not black, who was a man, who knew nothing about adoption, and it didn't go that well, right? Because in reality, the things that he needed were things that, you know, he knew he needed as well. He wound up going to this Adirondack Wilderness Camp, which I wouldn't recommend per se, but for him, it really worked. And he told us for the rest of his life, you made me go to that place where I had a poop in a hole for 6 weeks, you know. But it worked. And I remember going to the graduation of it, you know, and it was very moving. Because you haven't seen your kid in 6 weeks and you feel horrible. And for an adopted kid to be going away to something is really terrible, right? It's this other abandonment. And he was terrified that we would leave him there or he'd go to some other residential school, which of course the Adirondack Wilderness Camp was urging us to do, because of course they were connected to these schools, right? And they were telling us that we were wrong and it was terrible. But, you know, for him, it was a useful thing that kind of was a wake-up call and got him to think very differently. And he did come home and, you know, we continued to work with him. So, but no, you know, there were very limited resources at that time when you're trying to raise a teenager who is just being a teenager and struggling through some of this. And actually, I remember him and his brother both saying at a certain point, why don't you just return me to where we came from? It's like where? You know, like that agency in Texas where you came from? Yeah, just return us there. I was like, they don't take 20-year-olds. They only take babies, you know? And why would you even think we'd do that? Well, that's what you're gonna do to me anyway, you know, just getting rid of me. You know, it's always right there on the surface, right? So it's a very difficult, even when there's been permanence, that emotional context is right there. Again, lastly, I think, because this is a very long definition, right? Is permanence can be the result of preservation of the family, which means if we've done a good job with that, they don't even come into care. Which, you know, always a challenge, right? I mean, so many programs that would support families and keep families in their community with their own people and with their own neighborhoods and in their own systems can be a form of permanency. Reunification with birth family or legal guardianship or adoption by kin, fictive kin, and we were talking, I was talking with somebody about fictive kin, which is great that you guys have moved in that direction. And I actually saw some of your data. There were a couple hundred families in the fictive kin category, which is great, because the idea of people who are family as if they're family, that's what fictive means. It's a terrible word, because it sounds like fictional, right? But it means that, like, you know, this lady who your mother calls her sister, who's not really her sister, who's your aunt, is family. So she's fictive kin, or many other variations of that. People who are family as if they're family by blood, or maybe spirituality through baptism and stuff like that, you know, all different kinds. Or another caring and committed adult. So the idea is permanence is really about connecting young people to families, either their own birth family, the families they're related to, or another family that we will work with as if they're related to them. The challenge about adoption, and I've spent many years talking about and living through adoption, is that it's a phenomenal thing. But again, it's not a panacea. You know, it's, adoption can be very bittersweet for both all members of that group, right? The birth mother and father, the adopted person, and the adopted family. That there's it's a developmental process by which that person travels throughout the rest of their life. Two good books, just in case you're a book reader. The Family of Adoption by Joyce McGuire Pavo. I'm sorry, I am a professor, so I will give assignments. The Family of Adoption, Joyce McGuire Pavo, P-A-V-A-O. You can get it on Amazon.com. It's like 10 bucks. Phenomenal book about adoption through the developmental lifespan. And then the other one is called 20 Things That Adopted Kids Wish Adopted Parents Knew. Phenomenal book. My own kids read it, and I've given it to therapists who say they're adoption competent, but are not, and say, why don't you read this book? I think this will help you. Because most of our clinical folks are not adoption competent or foster care competent, and think they are, but they're not. So we need to do some work in that area too. But great book. And the author of that is, don't remember. But if you look at, on Amazon.com, 20 Things That Adopted Parents, Adopted Kids Wish Adopted Parents Knew. If you just put in 20 things, it'll pop up. Her name is escaping me. Great book, though. Okay, lastly, before we start to look at some of the real specifics about each of the permanency pathways, just kind of wanted to mention that a couple of framing things. Placement stability is not permanence. Okay, so even if we've got, you know, Mary living with Mr. and Mrs. Jones and they're wonderful foster parents and they promise that they will never ever, she's always gonna be part of their family, but they don't want to adopt her, that's wishy-washy, right? And I'll give you two great stories. They're sad stories, but they're real. We had a young woman who lived in a family in, I think, North Carolina. And she lived with a foster family who was a wonderful foster family for years, cared for her, and they wouldn't adopt her. They had older children, the older children didn't want them to adopt her. And they loved her, she was part of the family, great parents, and they said they would never do anything that would disrupt her, and don't worry about it, don't worry about it, but we're not gonna adopt her. Well, guess what? Mr. Jones dies. And Mrs. Jones then gets relocated to live with her son in the Northeast. And Ellen can't go with her. So what happens to Ellen? In the senior year of high school, Ellen needs to be replaced to another family, because we left her in the family that promised they would never do anything, and they were sincere, that would harm her. So what does Ellen do? She goes to school and puts up a flyer like this, saying, anybody who'd like to adopt me, please rip this off and call my social worker and let her know. I need a family. Because she was not leaving her school where she had done really well. And one of her former teachers adopted her, which is great. And former teachers, former childcare workers, foster parents are the number one, two, and three people that adopt our kids, right? Another very similar story, same thing. Kid was a wonderful kid, lived with his mom and dad, and they loved him, would never give him back, loved him, loved him, loved him, and then decided they were retiring and moving to a retirement community for 55 and older people where no one could live who was under 55, and he was in a different state. And they asked to have him replaced. And he was the captain of the wrestling team. And he just didn't know what to do. You know, he didn't want to start all over again. You know, he loved these people and they loved him, but they were going to now have to find another family for him. So he went to his teammates and told them what happened. And one of his teammates' parents, who thought he was a great kid and he was, said, I would adopt you immediately. And went through all the classes and did all the things she needed to do and adopted him. But I mean, in both cases, the kid found their permanent home, not us. Right? And we kind of colluded with the well-intentioned and good foster parents who said, we would never do anything that would hurt this kid. And they didn't mean to. But it's our responsibility to make decisions about the family and about the child and about permanency, right? And in that case, in both of those cases, it's really about what's in the best interest of that kid, not what's in the best interest of that family, right? Hard call, you know, and I know, I've been there. You know, I've left kids and families that gave me that same spiel, and it worked out. And then other families where, you know, due to circumstances beyond their control, that it didn't work out, bless you. And then all of a sudden you have a really, really horrible situation. How would that kid have felt if they were to leave their school and leave? As it was, it'll be unsettling to have a new family. But a little less unsettling because at least they were proactive on their own behalf. But I think it really is for us an indictment of like, we got to think better about that, right? And foster parents are wonderful people. I've been a foster parent, my parents were foster parents, but also I think, you know, foster parents were created to be temporary solutions, right? Temporary caregivers. And we've since in the field changed over to not just temporary, but also if we need you, permanent, right? And so it's always, and if we don't need you, they go back home. I met somebody also the other day, which was a great story. And he said, you know, they had this young child that lived with them, and they were sure he was going to be free for adoption, and they were ready to make that commitment. And then they did reunification. And initially they were devastated that they lost this kid that they loved and had since he was a baby, but they have a great relationship with his mother. And now the kid comes and visits almost every weekend, and they've done this bridge where he's still part of their family, but he's living with his mother. That's a great solution. And I said to him, who told you to do that? And he said, nobody. And at first we kind of were secretive about it. Why do people need to be secretive? Because we've built rules that say, you're not supposed to do that, right? But there's a great program about called Building Bridges in Virginia where they actually permit and encourage families to do that. So this idea of, you know, really how do foster parents and birth parents collaborate together? And I remember when my mom was a foster parent, she went to court with the boys one day. And the birth mom came, and it was supposed to be, you're not supposed to talk to her, you're not supposed to talk to her, you know, she's going to be really mad. And there was no social worker there, I don't know what happened. And my mother just, and this, their birth mother didn't speak English, they just hugged each other, which was the right thing to do, because here's my mother taking care of her children, and she's still a mother who loves her children. And yet, they were kind of told, don't talk to each other, which doesn't really make that much sense. So I think, again, kind of our way of thinking about permanency and stretching it further around the way in which we work with foster parents, we need to change. And people will say the same thing to me about like open adoption. Oh, it's really hard. Well, just because it's hard doesn't mean we shouldn't do it, right? And the same thing about foster parents. It's like, oh, that's really hard. They're good, you know, I don't want to screw it up. We don't want to bother. But just because it's hard doesn't mean we shouldn't do it, right? You have to think of other ways that really are about making it in the best interest of that child. Because a lot of the things that we do are really in the best interest of the parents or the system, right? Because of our rules. So what's really the best thing for that child? So and a couple of other things. A young person is either reunified with their family or custody transferred back, adopted by a relative or non-relative, placement with a custody transfer to a relative or kinship care, and then this idea of permanent foster care is not permanency, and independent living is not really a goal or a permanency pathway. Independent living is a service, which, believe me, every kid needs. And with my own children, I would say to them, you know, do you have any idea how much it costs to pay for electric every month? No, I don't know, and I don't care. They don't. Unless they sit with you when you, like, pay their bills and show them, and they still don't care. But at least they know how to write a check, if you do checks still and don't do them on a computer. But they kind of learn these things in families, right? And that's appropriate. Every kid needs that, right? Job seeking, job maintenance skills, emergency and safety skills, you know, all these things that we do in life skills and independent living. But that's not permanency. You don't live totally by yourself, right? You live within the context of other people. And when kids do live all by themselves, they'll tell you, it's really lonely. You know, I really wish I had other people with me that I could, like, learn from. So the concept, I'll just throw these up there quickly. permanency is often not clear for adolescents. We know that. And for children, it's probably less clear. Developmentally, teenagers are separating, so they're looking for their own identities and their own values. And it also occurs sometimes in the backdrop of distrust of adults. I'd say for children, it's probably the same. Children learn early on, you know, that this person told me this and it didn't happen. They promised me that, but it didn't happen. So they start to build mistrust if they hear things about forever families that don't seem to pan out. Young people suffer through separation, and frequently it's that they're scared. Fear is often masked as rebelliousness. And rebellion is usually rejection of anything that adults view as valuable, right? So you'll see young people really rejecting almost everything. I grew up Catholic, no, now I'm Buddhist. You know, you're Catholic, but I'm Buddhist. You know, and anything that the family values, young people say, I'm a different person, right? My Latino children who were Latino said, I'm not Latino, I'm African American. Okay, good. You know, they reverted back to being Latino eventually, right? But in the meantime, it was like, you know, African-American people in their eyes were much cooler, right? So that's what Travis especially did, the one who's going to be a father soon. I had lunch with him right before he left to go out. They moved to Las Vegas, and every day on Facebook, they're posting all these pictures. It looks like it was a good move. Also, this is the child who was arrested and did all kinds of horrible things and was saying to me before I left, do you think it would be okay if I like signed up for the police force in Las Vegas? I'm like, yeah, because you have a criminal mind. You'd be really good as a police officer. And he said, but you think all those things I did will show up on the record? And I said, no, you were juvenile, but you know, if you want to be honest about them, you can say, you know, when I was a kid, I did some crazy things. You know, that's honest. But I said, you know, it probably won't show up because you were, you know, a young, like a 13-year-old or a 14-year-old at the time. But it was funny to hear him thinking in that way. So this rebelliousness and this fear is a big piece. I love this quote, and this is a quote, real quote from a real kid about permanency. They're always talking about this permanency stuff. You know, social workers and lawyers, always using these big social work terms to talk about simple things. One day, one of them finally described what she meant by permanency. After I listened to her description, which was the first time anyone told me what the term meant, I said, oh, that's what you mean? Yeah, I want permanency in my life. I don't think I ever had it. When can I get it? You know, kids don't use that term, and neither do parents. Permanence is about connection, right? So if we use terms like connection with somebody, or would you like to be somebody who's important to you in your life for the rest of your life, and I'll frequently hear people saying, you know, somebody to go to on Thanksgiving, somebody to celebrate your birthday with, those are really important events for kids, right? There's nothing worse than working in a residential program and you have the five kids that have nowhere to go, right? Literally nowhere to go on Christmas, on Thanksgiving, on their birthday. It's the saddest place you could be, right? So, you know, you realize that these kids need, who will they go to when they're 30 and 40, right? So I love this definition. So what's that minute about independent living? Nothing wrong with it. It's not a permanency plan. It's a list of services. It's about promoting lifetime connections and family-based relationships. Again, lots of times, I think one of your things was about independent living too. I don't know if I put it up there, but again, that idea of if those kids are kind of in that kind of category, then they're probably young people for whom permanency is not easily achieved, right? So they become this kind of heightened group of older young people who really need permanence. And again, just not to overemphasize, but permanency for teenagers versus permanency for younger kids looks really different. So you have to think differently about both. Looking at a reunification as a permanency pathway, and I just kind of dragged out some data from the most recent AFGARs. You know, that number I mentioned before, 51% of the permanency goal of reunification, 55% who left care were reunited with their parents. I think that's actually flipped. I think I have that wrong. It was 55 had a goal and 51 actually were achieved. And of the an alumni study with 542 alumni in foster care, almost 88% of them reported being in touch with their biological families. This is another phenomenon that we see, right? A lot of wink, wink going on, right? Like, don't go visit your mother. You know, you're forbid. You know, her rights were terminated. Oh, okay, yeah, I'm not going to go visit my mother. I'm going to go visit my cousin. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and mom's there, and that's who you're visiting. But you know not to tell, because if you tell, they're going to tell you don't go visit them. So there's a lot of wink, wink of like, You know, and I think that that's also kind of really a challenge for the system, right? I mean, I remember boys that were in my program and they were 21 and leaving. They had been in care for 18 years. And who are you going to go home to? The mother that you we told you you couldn't live with for 18 years. Why did we wait so long? If she was, if she had changed enough that you could continue to live with her, why didn't we work with her previously? Now, some states are doing something really innovative with reunification, and they're reinstating parental rights. You have it here? Good. It's a great thing to think about. Now, sometimes adopted folks get really panicked about that, like, oh my God, what does that mean? You know, they're gonna come back and take my child? No, that's not what it was designed for. It was designed for kids like who are 17, who are living in this RTF that they've been in, there is no other option, and the rights of the parent were terminated when the kid was 6, now he's 17, the conditions are different, mom has a job, mom's got it together, she has other kids, or maybe she doesn't totally have it together, but it's together enough. Remember Winnicott? Good enough mothering, right? Is it good enough? Is it safe enough when you're 18? Okay? So I think, again, I'm not advocating in any way that people put children in places that are not safe, but the real deal is when they leave care, they reunify themselves. It doesn't really matter what you say. But what I think is, why do we take so long, right? Why didn't we ask mom or dad or grandma to come in and say, hey, what's different in your life now than when your rights were terminated? But we feel like, well, we don't have any business doing that because she's out of the picture. Legally, her rights have been terminated. We have no legal obligation to do that. But the reality is it's almost like fictive kin, right? We bring in the neighbor who was involved, and she doesn't have any rights because we know the kid has a relationship with them. So why are we not bringing in people who were truly related by blood? Whether the court severed that tie or not, that child will still tell you, that's my mother. Right? And I think it's a mistake of ours to not really think about how do we really begin to look at that differently, right? Now again, for younger kids, this is a different story, but families can and do change too. For younger kids, we're more, you know, we look more at relatives, we look more at adoption, you know, we're looking at different things. For older kids, we can look at guardianship, we can look at reunification, but in a different twist, and we can look at adoption. So I think, again, just to accentuate that, it's a little bit different. So important. So why do workers and children and youth or foster parents say no to reunification? It's just a few things, right? Beliefs and attitudes about the child and youth and their family, right? We still harbor lots of negative feelings about families. We do. When you really put yourself, you know, say, okay, you know, let me not put on my little NASW social work hat, but let me be real. You know, you realize, well, I don't really like these people that much. You know, they're really kind of bad. Or they did really bad things to that kid. Or they're kind of really messed up. You know, and it's just right on the surface. And that's our personal piece. The professional piece needs to be, how do we really work with families to make them partners? How do we really think about families as people who can and do change? You know, are they good enough in the sense of making those changes? And how do we really kind of, in a professional way, understand the stress, the trauma, the issues that that person has endured that kind of got them to that place, okay? The personal stuff is there too. It can't be helped, I think. Anyone who says it is lying. You know, we're maybe great professionals, but you know, you kind of go right underneath that, scratch the surface, there's a murderer under there, right? You know, there's something going on there that can pop right out. So we got to be honest about it. When students say to me, oh, Professor Mallon, is it okay to hate your client? Yes, it's completely okay to hate them, but it's completely inappropriate that they know that you hate them, right? So the reality is that it's possible when you work with clients to think, I don't really like her. And conversely, it's possible to like them too much, right? Because if we dislike them, we can like them too much. And you're like, oh, she's coming in. I don't really kind of like her. What's going on there with your counter-transferential stuff, right? So I think, but the professional and appropriate piece is, how do you treat people equally? How do you put it on a professional level? How do you work in the best interest of that child and that family? And kind of put some of that stuff to the side, right? Which is a challenge, but is what we're called to do as professionals, because we're not working in this as personal. If you were personal, you'd just be a volunteer. You know, as a professional, you know, you have credentials, you're paid, you know, you get trained, there's another whole thing. There's definite fear for young people's safety. There's always this over-fear, right? Like, well, they did all these things, so they're probably gonna do that again. But again, that kind of harkens back to, can families change? And this idea of, well, they've been in care for too long, right? You know, reunification is not a possible because they've just been in it too long. For the kid, they're fearing being hurt or disappointed again, right? And that's a normative fear. Although I would say that I've only met one boy ever in my whole career of thousands of kids who, when I said, you know, would you like to go back home to your mother? No, never. One kid. And I met kids who were brutally abused, and I would say to them, if we could fix things and you could go back to your mother tomorrow, would you? Yes, without a doubt. So that connection, that bond with family is really, really strong. Even kids who have endured incredible abuse, and kids blame us for taking them away. They don't blame their families frequently. You know, they'll say, that worker, that policeman came into my house and took me. My mother, yeah, she was getting high, but you know what? She was not a bad mother. And so there's that protective factor. And I think the reality is that kids never let go of that thing, that dream of going back home again, right? Even when they're teenagers. Foster parents fear for the safety of the child and the attachment to the kid and the fear of losing the kid. We ask foster parents to do an incredible thing. Love this kid like they're your own and be ready to give them back anytime we say they're ready to go back home. I know that's a gross overstatement, but it's also what we ask people to do, right? Love that kid like he's your own. Take care of them when they're sick. Be there in them in school. Love them, but don't love them too much because we might ask you to return them to their birth families because that's really our job. And that is the job of foster parents in the sense of providing temporary care and custody. But some of those other things I talked about, the bridge program and kind of linking foster parents, those are more healthy approaches to really working with foster parents and birth parents because I think really what we want to do is to support that birth parent, right? I remember this one dad saying, when I got my kids back, he had five kids, I was so excited that they came back. After the first weekend, I was thinking, I need a break. These kids are exhausting. And he said, the fact that I could call the foster mother and she always said, oh, I'd love to have them this weekend, he said, gave me a break. He said, and we actually were like almost co-parents with them because they loved her, they loved me, I wanted my children to be with me, but she also supported me as well as them. So a great thing if that can happen. Turning the no into yes, how do you explore permanency options as a process, not a one-time event? Couple of things. That last one is the one I'm talking about, bridging the gap. The process of building and maintaining relationships and communication between birth and foster families in a child's life with the goal of supporting family reunification or another permanency plan. It's online. If you look up Bridging the Gap in Virginia, we have a webcast about it. We had a father, the birth father, the foster parent, and the worker who did it. It was a great webcast. Really got them talking about those things. Visitation. Peg Hess, who is my very close friend, said, visitation is the heart of reunification. You don't do visitation, they're not going home. Bob Little, who was Malcolm X's little brother, who also was in foster care, and who was the commissioner in New York City, used to say to us that the visiting policies in prisons were more liberal than some of the visiting policies in foster care. And he always would say that, and people get annoyed at him, but that was the truth. And this idea of, well, we do it every other week. If you're going to reunify, it needs to be at least every week. And if you do community-based placements, it should be more frequent even than that, right? And again, people will say, oh, that's so hard. How do you do that? It's very complicated. You know, well, we don't have enough staff. You know, we can't just have that mother go into the foster parent's house and visiting without being supervised. Yeah, but just because it's hard doesn't mean it's not possible. So the idea of visitation and frequent, regular visitation. And you know, when kids are in agencies, it was like, I remember them saying, every other weekend they can go. And why not every weekend? Well, because they got paid on a per diem basis and they didn't want to, and kids came home late and then they wouldn't get paid. And there was a whole bunch of financial pieces. I don't know how you do your reimbursement here, but in New York, there was a per diem rate per kid. So they were allowed to go home every other weekend, but if you did it more frequently than that, then it impinged upon the budget. So it wasn't really about the kid, it was really about the agency. Child and young people must be collaborators in the process with agency staff working together. So this idea of, you know, and I even think with younger children, right? How do you prepare younger children for some of these things, right? My own child used to say he would finish school and then camp would start the next day and he'd never go. Never. And one day he said, you know, I just need a little time to transition from one thing to the next. Child of a social worker, right? And I'd say, oh, okay, I get that. He'd say, I just can't go the next day to a new thing. I need a little break in the middle. And I thought, well, that's true, right? Kids need somebody to sit and say, tomorrow we're gonna do this. Or, you know, in a couple of days you're gonna meet these people. Or we're gonna, I mean, so that's part of really engaging them as well. And foster parents can do that. It doesn't have to be the social worker, but I think the kids, even younger children, need an opportunity to transition. I mean, when you tell a kid that, you know, you're going out for the night and a babysitter's coming, they freak out sometimes, right? Well, they're all freaked out and crying and hysterical and vomiting and doing all kinds of somatic things so that you never go out again. My older kid used to do that. He was sick, stomach ache every time he went out. And you know, the first 15 times you're like not going, and then you're like, I'm never gonna leave this house. I need to go to the movies, you know, I need to get away from these kids a little bit. But you realize, you know, when you come back, they're alive still, you know, they're okay. But it's this, don't go, don't leave me, I'm you know, the abandonment stuff really kicks in. But I think that issue is really an important one, is how do you engage them? Wraparound services that are matched and tailored to meet specific individual needs, housing, community-based health, these are the things that we all need, right? I mean, that's why reunification is so complicated. It's like, okay, mom needs drug treatment, a house, healthcare services, new friends, you know, everything, right? She needs to be completely revamped. It's like a giant makeover, you know, for mom, because nothing really that she has would help her continue to be a good parent. And that's exhausting, right? I mean, and I'm sure Illinois is similar to New York in that housing is expensive and hard to find, right? So, you know, that in and of itself, and forget it, and what about drug treatment, right? I mean, I think it was the director was talking about the big thing, the big three in child welfare are domestic violence, substance abuse, mental health care, under a big, thick umbrella of poverty, right? Those are the things that we see in every case, almost every case, right? So you see mom or whomever got a substance abuse problem, she has a mental health condition that she's probably anesthetizing herself from with the drugs, and she has a boyfriend that is abusive at times, not always, but a lot of it, and she's poor. So these are huge problems, and one of the things that we frequently focus on first is the substance abuse, because it's the one that usually got them, that got the kids into care at the first place, right? Mom left them for 3 days, they had no food, they're walking in the street, you know. We've all heard that story, right? So, you know, then you try to find a drug treatment program that will deal with mom, and then the kids are in care, and if mom doesn't make it in that program, and then has to start all over again and go to another program, the clock is ticking, right? Very complicated. Very few programs that will take children with the parent. There's some of them around the country, not many. Right, huge. So the kind of, these are huge issues to attend to. Intensive family-centered home-based services that ensure adequate network of support when once they're reunified, huge. You know, what is our visiting strategies when the kid does go home? You know, once a week, once a month, right? You're on call. And you know when a kid's been out of the house for a while and then they're back in the house, that's really unsettling, right? Mom's kind of used to not having a child in the house, and now you're really stuck with a child all the time, and if it's a younger child especially, you know, you can't just leave them, and who's your social support network, right? Belief that children and families can and do change, and restoring parental rights. So we mentioned a little bit of that. So with respect to reunification, and again, I think the idea of, reunification, and the last one is celebrate reunifications, and good supervision and case consultation, that's, I don't want to lose that one. I mean, the idea of how do supervisors supervise to a permanency plan of reunification? A little bit different than how you'd supervise to an adoption, how you'd supervise to guardianship, how you'd supervise to kinship. Probably the one that, you know, most supervisors probably would get most concerned about, right? Because there's probably more variables of things that can and do go wrong in a reunification. I mean, in each of these, there are things that can be challenging. But in reunification, there's a lot of variables that can kind of, you know, get messed up. So supervisors need to really support workers in how do you supervise that situation. You know, you don't bring them back too quickly. You know, how do you put more intensive services in the home? Do you have time to do that? Are you budgeted to do that? You know, a lot of these things also are budgetary concerns and issues that you need to rethink. How do you do that when you have a lot of kids in the status of reunification? You know, it's not as easy as, as you know, I'm just maybe suggesting. This was a little quote from a kid about reunification, a little bit of a different twist. My dad was in jail and I never really knew him. I had been in foster care for almost 8 years. I was 15 years old and had no connection to my family. One day my social worker asked if it would be all right if we wrote to my father in jail, and I said, fine. I always think that's the fine. It's like, I don't really believe you, but fine. I'm just gonna shut you up and do this, right? I never thought it would happen, but he wrote back and we began to have this relationship, and after 16 months he got released and I began visiting him. It was great to get to know him, and after 6 months he asked me to move in with him. I never thought this would happen, but my social worker pushing me to reconnect with my dad was really what brought all this about. And again, I saw this play out just last week in New York. We have a family finding program that we're evaluating in an agency, and we had a mom and a kid on a video, and then we had one of the workers read a letter that the dad had written from jail, and his was a little different. It was like, I'm not getting out, but I'm gonna tell you all the relatives that you should call from my side of the family so that they can connect with my son, because I feel hurt about being in jail and not being able to be there, but I'll give you everything you need from me and cooperate in whatever way you need me to cooperate to help my son. And please tell my son to write to me, and please tell my son that I think about him every day and I want to be part of his life. You know, and he was clearly not coming out anytime soon, but he still was able to provide the support, and it was because the worker pushed the kid to write the letter. Again, a little out of the box, right? You know, we have all this fear about, oh my God, you know, they'd never be, you know, they were a felon, you know, they'd never be able to care for this kid, they'd never pass the background check, blah, blah, blah. Right away, I have a million things about why they shouldn't be involved. But, you know, you're not asking the kids to move in with them. But you might be asking for resources, you might be asking for family members, you might be asking for just support. And, you know, kids without the reality of being able to visit are having this fantasy about what's going on. So, you know, why not kind of buy into having that dad be able to be a parent to that child, or mom, as much as they can, even though they may be incarcerated. This is a little bit about custody of transferred relatives, excuse me. All right, and basically, you know, you have a huge group of folks in this category, right? Kinship care is defined as the full-time care, nurturing, and protection of children by relatives, and in some situations, fictive kin. Right, which is defined, I didn't have your definition, so I didn't put it up here, but each state through fostering connections was able to provide their own definition of what fictive kin is. Do you have any idea of what it is, Rachel? I mean, is it?
We use the same definition as we do for relatives.
Okay, fine, good. So it's not by blood though, but you know, not just by blood.
Close emotional personal ties
to a child. Okay. Kinship care is defined as placement of a child in custody in a home in which one of the responsible caretakers is a person related to the child by blood, marriage, or adoption, and broadly or emotionally tied to them, and includes at times siblings, because we don't often think of older siblings as permanency resources. Grandparents, grandmothers are the biggest of all caregivers, right? In kinship care, aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews, first cousins on both sides of the family, and that's a big piece, is when we look at kin care, we always look at mom's people, right? What about, and the thing that workers always say to the young girl who has a baby is, who's the baby's daddy? And she says, I don't know. Wrong question, right? Who's the baby's daddy's people? Better question. Because Mrs. Jones, who is the baby's daddy's mother, is very involved. And her daughter is very involved. So I think to some extent we would completely negate dad's people because we don't think about it. When I did intake, I would do intake work and I would be on the phone, mother's name. I didn't even ask father. I was writing unknown before I asked. And then, of course, then we started to change and we would ask. I remember one kid coming into care, and I said, well, you know, blah, 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 your mother, blah, blah, blah. He said, well, you know, my dad's very involved in my life, too. I said, I thought your dad was dead. You know, that's what it said in the intake. No, he had a very good relationship. But we didn't even think about fathers. So, but not just father, paternal relatives, paternal resources. Some of you, I'm sure, have seen that movie, Antoine Fisher, right? Yeah. Phenomenal movie that really speaks to that, right? This kid's focused on mom, mom, mom. He finds mom. She's very mentally ill, very seriously mentally ill. doesn't provide him with that much information, and then he winds up, I think he was in Chicago, right? The film was filmed there, and he goes to a barbershop in the neighborhood, and people in the barbershop start saying to him, you look like so-and-so. And so-and-so happened to be his daddy's people. And then he started to connect with them, and then they became this huge support for him that he never even knew existed. So I think, again, and actually we're finding this in family finding also in this one agency, is when we talk to kids about their resources, they'll say, they'll tell you about their father's people. And then the worker will always say, well, no one ever told us that before. Well, they didn't ever ask the question, right? And in this particular project, we have family finders who are not the kid's social worker. And that makes a difference too. And kids will also say, well, I didn't tell her because I don't want her in my business. So they were withholding information, although they would see those folks, they just wouldn't tell the worker because they were just withholding the information because they didn't want people in their business. Because they knew that if they told them about some of these people, they'd say, well, you can't go visit them. So again, a safety issue is a concern. Current or former spouse of any of these people, child step-parent. You know, I think, you know, we sometimes focus, I don't know if you're using concurrent planning, but sometimes we use that strategy to think about, you know, not plan A then plan B, but plan A and B simultaneously together. And to some extent, you know, custody to relatives or kin, fictive kin, can be a concurrent plan, right? This idea of working towards reunification of family or biological parent, birth parent at the same time as developing an alternate permanency plan. And I think this idea of returning home but may have a poor prognosis of returning home is one of the reasons that you might use concurrent planning, right? Concurrent planning is very cumbersome, I think. We wrote a whole curriculum about it. You know, it's very, there are concepts in concurrent planning that are wonderful because you're kind of moving down both paths simultaneously, but there are complications to it. I'll tell you the biggest complication to concurrent planning is full and open disclosure, is that people don't talk straight up to families. Because they're afraid if they say that, then the family either gets totally discouraged and is out of the picture, or they get mad, or whatever. So this concept of full and open disclosure, which is one of the elements of concurrent planning, is really critical. And I think in relative care, it's a critical element as well, right? Because there's a lot of wink-wink that goes on in relative care, too. Is your daughter visiting? No, she never visits. She does, right? Do you ever leave the children unsupervised when your daughter's there? No, never. Wink-wink. You know, mom's there all the time. I mean, it's her daughter, right? So again, how do you not let the wink-wink go by without kind of saying, how do we actually use that, right? How do we actually engage mom in a different way, right? Well, I'll get to that. A great webcast that we did with Dr. Joe Crumley, who is, I think, the national expert in kinship care, wonderful man. From Philadelphia. I did this kind of back and forth question and answer with Joe, and we talked a lot about kinship care, and we actually have a really good curriculum on the National Resource Center website around curriculum kinship care as well, so some good resources. This is another quote from another kid about kinship care. My younger brother and I live with my grandmother because my mother has a drug problem. I'm 17 and my brother is 10. My mom has been in several drug treatment programs and always drops out before she finishes. We always hope that this will be the time she gets it together, but she never does. My grandmother's a great lady and takes great care of us. Every time we go to court, she tells the judge she's willing to keep being our parent, but she feels guilty about adopting us. After a bunch of court dates, the judge finally asked to meet with us and asked what we thought about adoption. We told her that we just want to stay with our grandmother and not be adopted. She's already our family. The judge said that she would permit our grandmother to maintain custody, which means we can stay with her permanently, and that works for us. So, a great example of for these two boys what works. And for these two boys in particular, they've been with their grandmother a very long time, and mom had many attempts at becoming sober and was not able to really achieve it. And at a certain point, mom has another baby, and the younger kid really confronts her and says, you know, you don't even take care of us. Like, why are you having another baby? It's really, he was very direct, this little 10-year-old. And they realized at a certain point that they were really just going to live with their grandmother, and that's where that was their parent, and that's who they would be with. Couple of advantages of relative care: enable young people to know who they know and trust, reinforces their personal and cultural identity. Nothing worse than when we take children from one family and put them in another family that's so different from the family they came from that they just don't know the rules, right? I remember two Latino kids that I worked with went to a family that was not Latino, and they didn't know how to take care of their hair. They fed them different food. There were different rules. The kids were like totally thrown and further traumatized by living in this family than they might have been living in the family that they had lived in where there was alleged abuse, right? So cultural issues there. The placements are usually more stable. We encouraging families to cultivate and rely on their own strengths and resources. Sorry, my phone is buzzing. Juvenile justice involvement, as per some evaluation, is less likely. Subsequent reports of abuse and neglect are less likely. And in one particular study, found that 4% of the young people needed psychotropic meds in kinship care, as opposed to 26% of kids who were institutionalized and 21% who were in foster homes, right? So some, you know, for lots of different reasons, there's some advantages for relative care that is important. So these are some of the reasons why people might say no. Workers and foster parents, you know, this idea of the apple don't fall far from the tree. You ever hear that one? Mm-hmm. And even if they don't say it out loud, people think it, right? Joe Crumley actually has a really good comeback on that. It's like, well, you know, the apple tree's got a lot of apples. Some of them are bad, and most of them are really good. So, you know, not all the apples are rotten and fall off the tree. Child and youth fear of being rejected by family members. And I would say to some extent, with families, you know, I don't want to get involved because I've done this. They burned that bridge. Oh my gosh, they told me before that they would only be gone for a week and they were gone for a year. You know, there's a lot of history, right? So there might be some issues there. And then with foster parents, again, attachment and fear of losing a child, you know, or I've heard many folks say, you know, this kid was really doing well in this family, and then all of a sudden this family member came along and then they were sent to them, right? And that they didn't even know this family member, and all of a sudden the family member came along and they were sent with them. So there are issues around why workers and foster parents might say no. Turning no into a yes. I've been talking a little bit about family search and engagement, 6 steps to finding family. This was a really big thing that the feds were promoting a couple of years ago, but it's actually really great work. It's really like, you know, unpacking, you know, where family is and really doing searches using internet. Any of you have tried to find somebody, like somebody you went to high school with that you really liked and you lost track of? You can find them on Facebook. Yeah. I found a friend. I couldn't find her. I knew she had gotten married and changed her name. I couldn't find her. I texted somebody else on Facebook and said, have you heard from so-and-so? And they said, I think her married name is this. I found her husband. I wrote her husband a note and said, look, you know, I just want to say hi. I just want to get in touch with your wife. You know, we were not boyfriend and girlfriend. Don't worry. You know, but I just want to, you know, say hi. And he connected us. And it was like one, you know, like 3 steps. Right? I mean, it took me a long time to find her because I didn't think of talking to the other person, but you can pretty much find anything about anybody. But some of that's web-based stuff. I think the problem is, what do you do when you find them, right? That was one of my problems with Kevin Campbell, because he was really good at teaching people how to find them, but he didn't tell you what to do once you got them. You know, so what do? You say, oh God, we got a sibling group of 6 that needs a family. Clack. Yeah. Yeah, you have to really work with people to say, these are family members who need your help, and there's all these steps about doing it, which I think are worthwhile. And these are the guiding principles. And they're all online. If you look on family finding, they're all right there. And what also, again, this harkening back to this place I'm doing the evaluation with, you know, we counted the connections. And the kids started with 2 connections. And by the time the intervention was done, they had like 39 family members who could visit on holidays, who would call them on the phone, who came to the campus to visit them, who they went to visit. You know, these are really important things for young people when they think they have 0, and in reality, they have this support that they didn't even realize they had. These are a couple about key questions. And again, for workers, this kind of changes the narrative a little bit about finding families. Who cared for you when your parents could not, right? Who paid attention to you, looked out for you, cared about what happened to you? With whom have you shared holidays and special occasions? Because kids will say things like, I remember I used to go to Miss Ann's house every Thanksgiving. Well, who is Miss Ann? She lives across the hall from my mother. Oh, is Miss Ann still live there? I don't know, maybe. And then you can reach out to Miss Ann and find out that, yeah, she does still live across the hall, and she always thinks about those kids, and she'd be really happy to know that they're doing well and actually to have them come and visit her. So you get some of these things by asking kids some of the questions, right? Wraparound services and support, again, bridging the gap can be useful for kinship parents as well. The other big thing that people have been promoting, and especially Casey, is permanency roundtables and permanency reviews. Really smart idea, but you know what? Nothing new, right? I mean, it's an important, and not to diminish it, it's a very important kind of way of thinking about permanency, but it's not like something that we haven't done before. It's just kind of thinking a little bit outside the box of like really looking at the permanency resources that this child had or didn't have. What went well, what didn't go well? I mean, again, I had a story of a worker who was a new young worker, and the kid kept saying, 14-year-old, 16-year-old boy in a residential program. And of course, once kids go in those residential programs, they don't come out, right? If you want to look at real permanency, that like 208 of them that are in residential care, that's probably your neediest group in some ways, because they stop working on permanence once a kid is in residential treatment. That's because it's not designed to really, it all becomes behavioral, right? And kids really get, you know, they're focused on what are they doing right now. And again, they're useful programs, but I think the idea of permanency doesn't get teased out. So this kid's in this program, and he keeps telling the worker, you know, Miss Samuels, who was my foster mother 3 foster parents ago, is great, and I bet she would love to see me if you would call her. And the worker said, well, you know, where does she live? And maybe we can look for her, and I'll look in the case record. And when the worker went and told her supervisor, she said, oh, you don't want to call her. That child set the fire in that lady's house. She's not going to want to hear from that kid. You know, that's crazy. You know, don't even call her. So the worker kind of said, maybe I'll put that on a back burner. But the kid kept saying it again and again and again. Finally, the worker went into the case record, dug through the case record, found a phone number for Ms. Samuels, and called her. And Ms. Samuels was thrilled to hear about this kid and thrilled to think about having a relationship with this kid again. Again, a little bit outside the box, right? And again, kind of a young worker who's sometimes, you know, not supported necessarily by the person who's more seasoned, who's saying, oh, you know, kids always say those things. But I think when you start listening to kids differently, which is important to do, we need to kind of even kind of go down the pathway that might seem a little bit crazy. So permanency roundtables can be useful. Permanency through adoption, exploring adoption for older kids and younger kids in foster care is really important. I think the biggest mistake we make on the older side is we ask kids one time, would you like to be adopted? And they say no. We check the box and we never ask them again because they said no. And we want to respect that, and we don't want to bug them, but they said no. So multiple times of talking to young people about adoption is really important. And I think for younger kids, I'm coming over here because I feel like I'm neglecting you people, is for younger kids, and I'm mic'd up, right? So for younger kids, you really need to talk them through adoption and talk about what adoption looks like. Because there's a lot of fears associated with adoption too. Oh, I'm never gonna see my family again. I'm gonna have to change my name. They're gonna change my first name. And believe it or not, I have heard people that do that, which I think is criminal, right? You know, you have a 10-year-old kid and they change the name of the kid. You know, not because the kid wants to change the name, but because the family decides this kid needs a fresh start. But again, some of it is like, as workers, we need to be able to say with authority, that's not a good thing, you know. Like, I know you want your child to have a new life and to have a happier life than maybe they had, but you know, changing Peter's name to John like that one day is gonna be really hard for him. Maybe you could change a middle name for him, you know? But again, I think sometimes we're excited that finally somebody wants to take this kid and we agree to do a lot of things that is probably not the smartest thing to do, right? A baby's different story. And I'll tell you the one story that was good. I had a girl named Brandy. And she said, when I get adopted, I want my name changed. I said, okay, why? Because I don't want to be associated with a drink because my mother was an alcoholic. Okay, well, that's a good reason for changing your name. And she picked a new name for herself, and that's great. And I think if the kid's all gung-ho about picking a new name, great, as long as it's not like some crazy name like, you know, a superhero or something like that. But I don't know, any of you who are Catholic, remember you used to pick out a confirmation name?
Yes.
My confirmation name is Barnabas, after a vampire from Dark Shadows. So, you know, if you let the kid pick the name, you might get a crazy name like Barnabas, who was like the lead vampire in Dark Shadows. So anyway, I think, how is it incumbent upon us as adults to really reframe the initial no to a yes, if you get a no? You know, and it is an adult responsibility to really think about, how do we get young people to look at permanency in a thoughtful way that is a lifetime kind of thing and not just a one-time kind of event. A lot of advantages to adoption. Legal status in a family, stability in lifetime connections, staying connected to siblings and birth family, which I think you need to say to kids, you know, even if it's a closed adoption, you can remain connected to siblings and other birth family members. Again, sometimes that's something you need to work out with the court before the adoption is finalized, but again, it's kind of what's in the best interest of the kid. Sometimes adoptive families will say, no, we want a completely closed adoption, it's a brand new start. But these are sometimes older kids who remember their families and remember their siblings and really want to have some connection. Typically, adoptions are more permanent and legal, of course, and society as a whole benefits when permanence is attained in lieu of a child aging out of foster care, obviously, right? There are many, many more benefits when it's a permanent connection through reunification or through adoption or through kinship care. This is another real story from a real kid. This is a sad story, but has a good ending. I always thought that I was adoptable, even though I was 16 years old, but my social worker kept saying I was too old every time I asked him. Big problem, and social workers are still saying that. That's a big impediment to permanency, right? If the social worker's saying, no, honey, you're too old, you know, you're gonna go on to independent living, you know, don't worry about this adoption stuff. Bad message. Again, it might be hard to find a permanent adoptive placement for a 16-year-old, but it doesn't mean it's impossible. And we certainly shouldn't say, you're too old. I worked after school at this hardware store, and the guy who owned it was so kind to me, and he was such a good guy, and I always talked to him. I never really told him I was in foster care, but one day we got to talking, and he started to ask me a lot of questions about my family, and then about my life in foster care. I invited him to my case conference because my social worker said I could invite anyone who I wanted to. Another powerful message. You can invite anyone you want to this conference. And at that point, he asked about adoption. I was shocked at first, but it made sense. We finalized my adoption 3 months ago, and that was the happiest day of my life. So it's like, this kid again found like her own family to really, you know, be part of her life because she saw this man as a resource when other people didn't see him as a resource. Okay, a couple of things about why do workers say no to adoption. The kid's already stable, why upset things? The kid is too unstable, doesn't make sense to do it now. Let's wait until they're emotionally stable, and you know what the real deal is? They're never gonna be ready. Right? I'm not saying that, you know, you put a kid who's in crisis in this, but, you know, a lot of times we have these unrealistic expectations, and part of the reason why they're so unstable is because they have no permanence, too. So that's a big part of it. Some young people are too developmentally disabled, mentally ill, or have too many issues to achieve permanence. Wrong message. Not true. Some developmentally or physically disabled kids are, it's much easier to find permanent families for than a teenager, okay? Why do we get no from the foster parent? Why do parents say no? Fear of committing to a child, fear of losing resources. One of the things I hear over and over again is I've heard workers say, don't let that kid get adopted before whatever age it is, because then they're going to lose their educational benefits. And it's like, oh crap, why are we saying that, right? Or, you know, they're going to lose the independent living stipend if they get adopted. It's like, if they get adopted, they'll have a family. They might not need the independent living stipend, right? But we have these messages that are bureaucratic messages that we put out there. I just heard one last week when I was in some place. And, you know, this woman was really strong about the message. And I said, I'm sorry, you're wrong. That's a bad message to be sending to people about why this kid shouldn't get adopted for 6 more months. That, you know, she's going to lose the benefit. And it's like, we want kids to have the benefits they're entitled to, but we also want them to have permanent resources. Why do parents say no, delaying or not addressing it, or saying no directly? Why do children say no? A lot of reasons. I don't want to betray my birth family. Don't want to lose contact with important people. Don't want to change my name. Families are for little kids. I love this one. My mom said she would come back. I had big 20-year-old boys telling me that. My mother said she would come back. I can't get adopted. It's like, honey, you know, you've been in care for 21 years. You know, you can still have contact with your mom, but, you know, you need something else too. No one will want me. I don't want to risk losing anything else. And this is a big one. I'm too destructive, and I'll just mess up again. And that's what a lot of them have been told, right? You're too destructive, and younger kids too, right? I mean, my daughter, Leslie, no one adopted this kid. No one took her as a foster child. She was like a little girl living in an institution. She was strange as all get out, but nobody, she was, and still is as an adult, very strange. But it didn't mean she couldn't live in a family. They never even tried, never. She never lived in a family. She lived in an institutional placement from the time she was 12 weeks old until the time she was 16. So a lot of her behaviors are institutionalized behaviors, right? They don't have anything to do with her diagnosis. So I think, you know, also this idea of, you know, she was too developmentally disabled or had too many problems to even try. Again, some of these are reiterative. Getting young people involved in the process, involving them in recruitment efforts, involving them in identifying people that they think might be helpful, helping to work on our changing our own kind of views about adoption or permanence. That's a big piece, right? We hold on to these little, we had one case where this happened, right? And we're never gonna do that again. You know, or we tried this one time to reunite that kid with that mother and it was a nightmare. We can't do that again. You know, and you know, you do have to use your own practice wisdom, but at the same time, maybe one case is not enough, right? So how do we look a little bit more? And as a supervisor, how do you stop yourself from saying that old person thing, which is, well, we tried that 15 years ago and didn't work really well. I say that, I have to stop myself. We tried that, I have this young, you know, puppy of a worker coming in and saying, I'd really like to do this, and I have to stop myself from saying, well, we tried that 20 years ago and didn't work. And I just say, okay, well, you know, I think that's a good thing that maybe we should think about. Like, why don't you bring it up at the staff meeting and why don't we talk about it with other people and let's get some input from them. I have to stop myself from saying we did that 15 years ago. Because there's not a lot of new ideas sometimes. There are old ideas that keep coming around and around. If you've been in child welfare long enough, you know that, right? Here's some other questions to throw out there. Who are three important people in your life with whom you've had the best relationship? Would it help to review where you lived? Even with younger kids, you know what they'll say to you too? Mrs. Jones, Mrs. Stevens, Mrs. something, and you know what, I don't remember. They stop at three, they don't remember. There's so many people that we've had kids live with that they forget who they were, and they stop at a certain number. Who would you like to stay connected to and why? With whom have you felt connected to in the past? Who do you like, enjoy being with, admire, wanna be like? Who believes in you, stands by you, compliments and praises you? Who would you call if you wanted to share good news or bad news? And I always add, at 2 a.m. Right? Think about that. You break down along the street, along the highway, who do you call? Most of us have a couple people. Kids in care have nobody. They'll say, my worker, but I don't really have her number. I'd call 911. I've heard a lot of kids say that. I'll call 911. Well, that's good. But have a person that you know. I can't think of anybody. This is something that a friend of mine drew up, which I thought was really funny and great. It's like, what do kids say they want to hear from people who want to be permanent resources to them? These are the questions for the people. Have you ever been a parent? For how long and how many kids did you have? Why do your kids leave your care if they did? Can you show respect for a teenager and how will you show it? Can you meet a teenager's needs? What will make you give up on me? Can you please provide a letter of reference from a young person, especially one who has been in your care? Wouldn't that be great, right? And there's really no reason you couldn't do that, but I mean, I don't know any place that ever has, but a couple of things about strategies, things you could think about that are useful training-wise. This is a child and youth voice in recruitment. It's called the Adoption Chronicles. They're right there, and again, I'll send this to Rachel and we can email it out to people. It's just stories, the kids talking about their lives, and one of the nice things about them is they're these older kids, but they act like they're 13, right? It's a 19-year-old boy, but he's acting like he's 11, because developmentally, that's where he's at. So, you know, you're saying to somebody, this 19-year-old needs a home, but really when you see him, he's like an 11-year-old who really wants a puppy.
You know, like that's his dream in life, you know. This 357 model that was developed by Darla Henry and people at Temple is a really great model of thinking about permanency differently. They have five questions, seven critical skills, three tasks. It's a kind of a strategy of working and looking at permanency differently. How do you get workers to think about this? Well, addressing concerns, diligent recruitment, targeted recruitment, child or youth specific recruitment. We do too many of those adoption fair kind of things still, right? Some of them are like terrible, I think. I don't know how you do it, I'm not criticizing you, but some of them are like slave trading, right? You bring these kids up, you parade them on the stage or you know whatever, and it's like, oh, I don't know, you know? And I think their opportunity, or you put a big name, like teenagers hate this, you put a big name tag on them, Barney's dancing around, you know, they don't want that. They're not coming to that recruitment thing, right? We've done these digital stories with older adolescents where they make a story about their lives and then families can watch it. Or they'll make a story, and actually, maybe at the question and answer thing, I'll show a little video because it's like about two. It's about a young man who desperately needed a permanent connection and an adult who was the permanent connection who desperately needed a young person in his life. And they're beautiful because if you show the story by itself, the boy's story, somebody's watching that and saying, that's a great kid. You know, like, it's kind of like the Wednesday's Child thing, right? You know, where they flash up this kid and this kid is great and they get 1,000 calls about that one kid, you know, and you wish that it was your kid that we were getting 1,000 calls about. But again, it's a way of getting people aware. And I think just generally, the general population doesn't really understand foster care. They think they get adoption. They don't get that either, but they think they get that a little bit more. But foster care, they still don't get. I mean, until the day my mother died, she'd say, you work with orphans, right? Yeah, Ma, I work with orphans. Because she never really understood the concept of foster care as many times as I tried to explain it to her, you know? Resource parent retention, that's a big one too, right? I mean, you get these folks and how do you retain them, right? Because it is not easy. And I think we have good people and we exhaust them, right? Come on, please take one more. Please, it's Friday, it's 5 o'clock. Please take this one kid, I swear he's gonna be a great kid. You know, and we've exhausted that one foster parent who really is ideal and is wonderful and is doing great stuff. And I think sometimes we have to say, accept their no, I'm doing as much as I can. I wanna be helpful and I wanna say yes, but I'm doing as much as I can. But there's other way to retain foster parents too, just kind of making them part of the whole process, right? Thanking them for what they do. You know, acknowledging how challenging and difficult it can be to be a foster parent, right? Those kind of things as well. Adult adoption, I mentioned that I adopted my daughter Leslie when she was 37. We did a whole, people kept saying to me, how do you do that? It's like, it's not that hard. But we did a whole kind of tip sheet on adult adoption, which is right there. And you can download it. And it's, you know, jurisdiction by jurisdiction, it's slightly different, but it's really not that hard. And the other thing that I've seen, I have another friend named Mary Keene who adopted like 12 kids, and people say, oh my God, 12 kids. Like only two of them live with her. The other 10 are like in their 20s. They're still her kids, but she adopted them as older people because she would say to them when they lived with her, would you like to talk about adoption? And many times they'd say, nope, love you, Mary, but nope, don't want to do that. And then 2-3 years later, would say, Mary, I've been thinking about that adoption thing. I think I'm ready. And then she would adopt them as older young people. We had this one little young woman on a webcast with us, and she was great. She said, Mary asked me that question. I told her no, and then I changed my mind. And then I swore to myself I would never ask her myself. She would have to ask me. And then one day she asked me, and I was like so thrilled that I said, oh, of course, I've been waiting for you to ask me. And she said yes, and she was like 27. And got adopted. And she had already had her own child and was living on her own, but she was really wanting that permanent connection. So it's not too late. What do you do to unpack the no? Exploring permanency as an option, as a process, not a one-time event. Preparing families. Supporting permanency with relatives. I'm going to just skip over APLA. I think I've already decimated what APLA does, right? And then, you know, kind of continuing the conversation, right, is with young people too, is, you know, talking, and you know, it, with young people, we make the assumption for them, of course that 2-year-old needs a permanent family, right? Of course that 6-year-old needs a permanent family. What about the 7-year-old fire setter though, right? What about the one who's been sexually abused and is sexually abusing every single kid in the home, right? You know, people get really, somebody was telling me a story about this kid one day, and was like, and I just said, well, you know, and I think the issues of sexual abuse confound things for us, and we right away get into a mode of like, well, we couldn't put that kid in a family. Well, you can, but it's gonna require a very different kind of family, and it's gonna require a very different kind of circumstances around supervision, right? But we have that panic, and you know, it used to be fire setters, but now sexual abuse kids or kids who sexually abuse other kids could become a very big issue. Permanency toolkit, this is from the National Research Center. It's free, it's online, it's a good thing. Child Welfare Information Gateway, information about permanency, again, just kind of resources. Permanency packs, these are really great things. All it says is a little piece of paper that says, what do you commit to do on behalf of this young person? It's like a contract. Very simple, straightforward, really good little thing to kind of think about with especially preteens and teens. 6 Steps to Finding Family is all about family finding, again, a free resource. We Interrupt is a great movie. Actually, the little film that you all did was similar to We Interrupt. It was kids' voices saying what they need, but they're teenage voices. So they're really great. It's a great training tool, too, for those of you who do training. Digital Stories, which are all online, and at the question and answer, I'll show you 2 of them. They're like 3 minutes long. They're great. Cecilia Fermonti and Jennifer Rennie wrote this really great book called Making It Permanent, which is for judges, guardians, and attorneys about permanency. Well, a couple years ago, it's 12 years old, but it still has some real great relevance for judges, lawyers, attorneys around permanency kind of directives from a legal perspective, and something from the American Bar Association similarly. Unconditional Commitment comes from You Gotta Believe, an agency in New York City, which is a great film about foster parents and adoptive parents who made permanent commitments to older youth. It's great because it shows all of these real people talking about the challenges and the successes they had in making permanent connections. And that's something people need to see. Because in the film, like the parents are saying, it wasn't easy, but we didn't quit. And actually, in my own family, when people say to me, what got Travis to go back to school? I don't know. We didn't quit. Really, that was what it was. I mean, there were days when, you know, you would yank him down the stairs and throw him in the car and lock the doors and make sure he didn't leave. And it was horrible, and this is all before you go to work yourself. And then you're sweating, and you're upset, and you're frustrated, and then you open the car door to let him go into school, and he runs out the other door and runs down the street. You know, you're like, I'm exhausted. And then one day it changed, because you don't quit. So, I mean, I think part of it is that, and that's what this film does. It kind of challenges people to think about how do you stick with young people and don't quit, because I think that disruption part is when people quit. And there are times when people do have to quit. I acknowledge that. But I think too often they quit too quickly, or we let them quit too quickly without kind of really working with them. Mentoring USA, phenomenal program that links mentors with kids. And with respect to guardianship, I frequently think sometimes kids who start with a mentor and move to guardianship can move to a more durable permanency option later. A young man in Florida who was an older kid, and his worker said, we're going to find you a mentor. And he said, oh, crap, another person. You know, I'm sick of this thing. You people are always finding me these people and never work out. But they found him this mentor who was an attorney. And the kid liked him. And the kid started going with him every weekend. And the kid started going places. And finally, one point, the kid said, I think you're ready to be my guardian. Because you're a lawyer anyway, so you might as well be my guardian. So he did. And then a couple more months went by, and the kid said, I think you're now ready to be my foster parent. And the guy went through all the training and got licensed and had an apartment that was sufficient, and the kid came and lived with him as a foster parent. And then about a couple months later, he said, you know what, and now you're ready to adopt me. The kid set the tone, and they are now, you know, father and son living together in Florida. That started as a mentoring thing, went to guardianship, went to foster care, went to adoption. So I think sometimes these pathways that we might think of as not so durable can become more durable, especially when young people make the decisions about, you're ready now. And a colleague of mine, Maris Butchner, always says that you really have to listen to young people say when they're ready. You know, that this person's the person for me. They're ready. Oh, and this is my little prayer, my very Catholic prayer for all of you. is, because I think it's really a nice little one, says, and may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in the world so that you can do what others claim cannot be done. A good little charge to think about permanency, right? Because lots of people are saying, hey, it's never going to happen. It's really hard. You know, we're just where we need to be, and it's never going to change. And the reality is it needs to change, and it can change, and it will change. So. Okay, I want to show Casey. Okay, I just want to show you two little, what we call digital stories. They're like little three-minute stories that people make about their own lives. So we don't make them for them. They make their own story, and they tell their own story, which is sometimes what we hope they'll say, and sometimes what they just say because that's what they got to say. But these are stories we did in Maine a few years ago, and they're all really beautifully done, but I particularly like Casey and Martin. And it's a young person who needed permanence in their life and an adult with whom they found permanence. So we're going to watch Casey's story first, and then we'll watch Martin's story.
As a 17-year-old criminal, I'd spent most of my life making the worst of every situation. I had no supports, and had spent the last 3 years floating between foster homes, group homes, couch surfing, and eventually being completely homeless. I was lost to the point that I would contemplate suicide daily, and at one point stood at death's peak. Every day another nail in the back, and the wall growing higher and higher. When I met Martin, I thought this was another nail in the back, with no way out. A few days after the new nail was in, I was shipped to a behavioral school in Bangor, called Job Corps. With Martin's help, I completed it. With the help of Martin and Job Corps staff, I soon went on to obtain both campus-wide and curriculum-wise most improved and completed my program. But it was after Job Corps that we obtained closeness. From the late night phone calls about moldy cheese to helping with the speeding tickets as he was training me to drive, from being the first person to defend me and take interest. No matter what it was, I knew Martin would be there to help me overcome whatever was there. Well, I never put down my biological family or gave them the reassurance of they were right. The permanent relationship turned a boy into a man and a mentor into a father. I went from the streets to a young author, speaker, and independent human being. And more importantly, creating more resources and building back burnt bridges. When Martin had his heart attack, it was Boston Mountain, where we filled the paperwork out and where both of us, including the nurse, said Michael at the same time, thus creating the middle name. But the permanency was in jeopardy when our hopes of achieving that permanent relationship were shot down by DHS. My father challenged me to take a stand, in which I did, writing a letter that initiated the change of the educational program policy and made it possible for my mentor to be my father.
And this is Martin's story, who is his father.
I met Casey in my role as mentor through a new program in Maine. I mentored Casey through several transitions, and I experienced transitions as well. I went from professional casework supervisor to being Casey's dad. During the first meeting, when he described being homeless, I felt protective of him and wanted to be beside him and advocate for him. His interest in social relationships helped focus Casey on rebuilding damaged relationships as well as building strong supportive relationships now. Casey quickly learned to clarify goals and accept his ability and his power to achieve his goals. Casey became my son when Casey's sneakers wore out. It was late fall and his feet were being injured from wearing wet sneakers. DHHS wouldn't buy new sneakers. My protective feelings took over when I took Casey to a store to buy sneakers for him. Casey was sitting on the floor trying on cheap sneakers with a big grin on his face. And I thought, I want that kid to be my son. The first Christmas when Casey was 17, and bought presents for his whole family was the first time I told Casey I loved him. I experienced serious health problems requiring emergency surgery. When Casey expressed anxiety about my possible death, His anxiety about his lack of permanency began creating the question, what are we? On Black Friday, I was standing in line at Walmart at midnight. I thought, this kid must be my son for me to be standing here freezing at midnight to buy a Wii. I agreed to let Casey drive my car so he could accumulate the required driving hours to get his driver's license. When we got a speeding ticket, we split the fine because he's my son. I had a serious heart attack. Casey and I had already discussed adoption. Casey took time off from work, bought a bus ticket to Boston, found my hospital, and we filled the adoption papers out in my hospital room. That's when Casey became part of my family. On November 11th, Casey became my legal son at age 20, and I became his legal father.
So they're like just little snippets of people's lives about, kind of, the thing I like about these is that it shows both the young person and then the adult. And the others are the same, Tyler and Rebecca. Tyler was an older kid. His siblings were already living with Rebecca. She wasn't sure about taking on another child in her family. He was older. She was worried about it, and she did. And then Rebecca tells her story about how he really rounded out their family. And then the other ones are similar. So. They're great little stories and important to check out. If I can get, can I get on the internet from here?
Yeah.
Because if I could show you one more.
Just click.
This is our digital stories from the field on the NRC website. Tons of different stories from young people about, and adults, and workers, and lawyers, and judges who talk about their kind of various perspectives in permanency. And I just wanted to show you, oh, this is my daughter Leslie's story, which I'll show you because it's a great little story. And you'll see a picture of me when I was 25 years old. Or not, younger than that, actually.
While I was growing up, the people who took care of me said I would never do half the things that I'm doing today. When I was living in New York Foundling Hospital, at the age of 7 and a half, just as I was adjusting to life at the hospital, I moved to St. Agatha's. I was 8 years old. Now I had to start all over again. Life on the campus was okay, but I had a hard time with reading and math. My teacher had no patience with me and would send me to the nuns for help. Sister Thomas spent a lot of time with me and taught me to read. At 13, I went to live in a group home. I was first place in special education classes, and the next year I was accepted to regular classes. I did well, proving my counselors wrong. I graduated from junior high school. In high school, I had a difficult time adjusting and was placed back into special education classes. All along, I really wanted a family. When I was 17, I finally went to live with a foster family. I had met my foster father, Gary, in 1977 when he was my child care worker. We were always close. Being part of a family is what it's like to live in the real world, not the world of moving from group home to group home. Then our family moved, and I enrolled in Job Corps to study nursing and get my GED. I got my nursing assistant certificate, but not the GED. At the age of 20, I moved out on my own and continued to study for the GED exam. It took me 17 years, but at the age of 36, I finally got it. For the past 10 years, I have been living in a supportive apartment program. I have continued to grow and have learned to accept adult responsibilities. 2005 was a great year for me. In January, I entered college and on November 30th, at age of 38, my foster father adopted me. Now I have my permanent family and a circle of friends, and I'm getting a college education that no one thought I would ever have.
I would have shown that this morning if I could have connected to it, but what she doesn't say is she took that GED test 17 times before she passed it, which is really pretty remarkable. She's very persistent. That's why she calls me 12 times when she can't find me. She's a very remarkable person. She's actually going to college now. She got her associate's degree, and then she is working on her bachelor's degree. So she's very, very driven, which is wonderful. But, you know, this is kind of what all of our kids have the potential to do, you know, is that we sometimes, you know, like her story is called, I'm More Than My Past. You know, we kind of dwell in, you know, well, are they able to really do that? You know, could they do that? And most young people really can, if they're given an opportunity and they have the kind of support that they need. So anyway, those digital stories are all on our website. Take a look at them. They're great training tools. I use them in teaching all the time just to illustrate and kind of bring real people into the room and kind of, you know, let them, and they all did their own stories, so nobody did this for them. They created them by themselves in a whole process that we have on digital storytelling, so they're useful. And there's stuff about foster parents on there too, and adopted parents, and lots of other things, so check them out. So, thoughts, comments, questions, things you want to ask? And because we don't have a mic for you, if you say the question, I'll repeat the question so that we can pick it up.
Well, I'll start. Dr. Fallon, we talked earlier. As I process much of what you said today, and just looking at you, look at the video, it's not really a question, it's a statement to your presentation. And as we were sitting here, we could see the glow and the pride in your face as you watched that video. And in working in the Division of Administrative Case Review, we reviewed cases of caseworkers as it relates to permanency. And I looked at all the concepts and some of the things you talked about in trying to encourage workers, agencies, supervisors, when you talk about the supervisory model. When I look at some of these stories that you've placed as exceptions to the rule, when we heard the director talk about supporting the systems and the collaborative systems, when I think about rules, policies, procedures, how do they translate into practice? When you have individuals on the front line, workers who have to believe in that exception, who have to, as you said, permanency is not a one-time thing, it's a process. How do you broach permanency, adoption, especially for older children, with a youth, for a worker, who is consumed by their daily chores, by an agency who sometimes may be committed more to the financial aspect of having a child in their program as opposed to achieving permanency. As you talked about some of the options and some of the bridges to permanency, I reviewed a case the other day of a 13 and a 10-year-old, and I can't remember when the goal of guardianship was established, but clearly these children have been in this home of a godmother, not a blood godmother, but a godmother, for 8 years. The agency, the judge, and the family decided, because now the children didn't want to proceed with guardianship, and the court has now changed the goal from guardianship on a best interest decision to continue in foster care, to allow these children to stay in this home until they reach the age of, as you stated, independence, which is not permanency. So when you have these systems that don't support or talk to each other, as we as administrators and folks who develop impact policy, procedure, we have systems outside of the child welfare system who are making best interest decisions, such as that for a 13 and 10-year-old. When the children were placed in this home, they were 5 and 2. And now the court has allowed these children to stay there until they're 15, 16, with someone who is under the guise of fictive kid now. Best interest decision. So, I mean, there's so many things that you said today, and it's real, no real answer. I'm not asking you to answer, but I'm so honored to have come here today to hear you speak in a manner to encourage us at this level, because we have to support the front line. It's the workers and it's the supervisors who have to be encouraged. And they need to see this. They need to see some of these digital stories to re-believe and to re-understand about those exceptions and about asking a child when it comes to permanency, involving a child in that decision, explaining to a child, explaining to caregivers. And they don't have the time to do that. And I see that every day when I review service plans of workers who complete that service plan 30 minutes before the review and haven't had a plan for 6 months. When you talk about visitation and how important visitation is for families, when the director talked about the front line, permanency and the urgency of permanency starts the moment an investigator knocks on the door. The moment a service plan is developed. And there's so many cons and so many things. And being a native New Yorker, I could feel what you talked about with every word you spoke. But here in Illinois, that application across the nation and some of the geographical things that impact what we do, statute-wise, financial-wise. And so I just want to give a testament to your presentation. And I'm just honored to have been here.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I believe that part of it is you can't teach passion about what you do, but I believe that everybody who does this has some level of passion in them, because there's so few kind of rewards to doing it, right? And I think that ultimately, I'm very wired up, sorry. Ultimately, you know, when you kind of really step back and look at it, I mean, there are people who, you know, can only do it 30 minutes before, and then there are people who do it at home, right? You know, and take their work home. And we were just chatting about, you know, kind of how difficult it is to use like certain search engines at work because you're prohibited from using them, right? Which is so frustrating because you know you could do something, but and you know, people don't really want you to do it at home, but yet I'm sure people do, right? Because no one's restricting your home computer, so you do it. And I think that there's lots of people like that. And I even think for myself, after being in the field for 40 years, there's kids that I worked with that I still think about, that we did a terrible job with. You know, and I don't always see them on the street, although occasionally I do and feel terrible. But I always think, wow, we messed up, you know, and we messed up that kid's life. You know, I was one time on 125th Street going home, and my colleague was with me, and somebody knocked on her window at a light late at night. And it was a kid that she worked with, and I said to her, huh, such a typical social worker. The kid is knocking on your window, and she's talking to this homeless girl. Within 3 seconds, somebody was knocking on my window, and it was one of my kids who was homeless. So we're sitting in this car at like 11 o'clock at night with these two homeless kids that we had worked with for many years, and we both drove away thinking, oh, that was horrible. Wasn't happy to see them because something failed along the way, right? And we have to take responsibility also for thinking of the times that maybe we didn't do what we should have done. So I appreciate your comments. I thank you. And I think that that's pretty much what people get challenged to do too. And as a supervisor, that's your challenge, right? I mean, I had a worker one time, I was telling her at lunch, she said to me she wouldn't take this kid on a home visit because his mother was dying and it made her uncomfortable. And I was like, I don't care. You have to go. Well, what made you, oh, my own mother died. Okay, well, let's talk about that a little bit. And then, like, you need to get over yourself and take that kid on the trip. Because it's really not about you. It's about the work that you're doing. But it was one of those things where you're like, wow. You know, you, of course, would think that somebody would take a child to visit their mother who's dying, right? But, you know, she gave me a million excuses about why she couldn't do that. She also resigned the next day, which made it easy for me. And then had a... told me the next day, I had a dream that I rescinded my resignation. And I said, and you accepted. And I said, that was just a dream, honey. But those kinds of things where you got good people and you got people who can only give that much, right? And you know, with the way that people have been there a long time, and it's also historical too, right? I've learned as I've gotten older, you know, my perspectives change. You know, sometimes I'm a little less passionate than I used to be. I'm a little more tired sometimes than I used to be. You know, but also I think we have to encourage newer workers to kind of, you know, also be enthusiastic and not kind of get into it. And, you know, I supervised 4E students in Louisiana, and one of the worst things that could happen was I would place them in agencies, in state agencies in Louisiana, and workers would greet them like this, oh, you don't want to work here. And I'd say, wow, why do you do that on day one? right? Oh, there's so much paperwork. You're going to hate it here. You have to go to court all the time. You're going to hate that. And it's like, can I give you like $1,000 to shut up, you know, as part of the grant? Because it would be worth it for them not to say those things to new workers when they come, right? And it's and I don't even think they mean to be mean. It just kind of comes out of people sometimes. So, but thank you for saying that. I appreciate all that. Other folks, things you're thinking about or? Yeah, we sometimes come out and work with a region or a jurisdiction. I think, Juliana, we were going to do some. We have a portable digital storytelling lab, so we can come and do them. And then I think they're wonderful for older adolescents to really think about their stories of what kind of family am I looking for? You know, and we've done them in lots of different ways. But yeah, it is. And you could email me or get in touch with me.
That's what we can do. I mean, we can continue with that momentum that started and just, I think, kind of across, because one of the questions I was going to ask was about with our LGBT youth, the sort of how we put them on an island, some of the tactics that can be taken to recognize that linkage with family is still possible, still good.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think that that's a tool that we need to use. And actually, we're in some conversation with training about utilizing those stories and embedding them in some new curriculum.
Yeah, Juliana and I worked on looking at policies for gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender questioning young people. And one of the things about permanency for those kids is that it used to be, oh, well, they got thrown out of the house and they're never going to go back. We're getting feedback on that. Am I standing too close to something? Maybe that speaker. And the idea was, oh, they'll never go back home because they got thrown out of their families. And that's really not true. I mean, there's ways of working with families for children, because that disclosure of coming out as gay or lesbian or bi or trans is a shock to the family system, right? It's like any crisis in a family. You know, the mom is doing laundry and finds a bag of weed. Oh my God, my kid's a drug addict, you know? Which I'm sure some of you have experienced that, I know I have. And you're like, what do I do? And I think with gay kids, it sometimes is disclosed in ways like that, and then it becomes ugly because it's a crisis, but it doesn't mean it has to stay ugly. And they don't all have to go into foster care because they're gay or lesbian or bi or trans. You know, so there's other kinds of ways of looking at that. And again, I was somebody who opened group homes for gay kids in New York and realized that was a big mistake. Because we created this system that didn't promote permanency and didn't promote family connection and created like a little oasis for them to live in this group home. And then when they left that group home, they did go back to their families, many of them. But it would have been nice if we had worked harder to keep them with their families in the first place.
So. And I think that goes to making sure that the work for permanence for all children cuts across all of our providers, because we do tend to silo our populations, LGBT youth, or
pregnant and parenting teens.
Yeah. And we have to hold the same standard, the same level of expectation that you're going to work towards. Residential or group home is a snapshot of time. It's a treatment. It's not a placement. It is work to be done with the child, and then where do we go? So we need that to permeate that sector.
And when I was talking about residential care and if kids go there, they don't get permanency, I don't mean to bash residential care. I think it's a useful tool. And I spent my whole career in residential care. But it's supposed to be temporary and time limited. And too often kids stay there a long time. And then things get focused on, oh, well, he's on the highest level of the behavioral system. And it's like, well, that's really good. But have you talked to the family lately? And it's like, oh, they're not involved. And before you know it, the kid's 18, and then they're 21, and they're ready to leave, and really haven't done that much around looking at permanency for them. So, because what happens in residential care is very different than some of the other systems. So, other folks, how about from this side of the room? You got anything going on over there? Hi.
I think for it becomes the biggest, I think our biggest struggle is with our court system.
Oh, yeah.
So we run into a lot of walls because we have a lot of, you know, state attorneys and judges who have their own personal bias against relatives and thinking outside the box for placement, especially over children. And it's hard to, especially if you're talking about to a new worker who's intimidated or trying to educate the more expressive.
Just so you guys can hear over here, what she's saying is that some of the obstacles you run into at times around permanency is related to the court system. You know, court folks who might have a bias against relative care or other issues. And I hear that all over the country. And it's so, you know, the courts work hand in hand with us, whether we like that or not. I mean, and they have a lot of authority. They actually are the ones who approve the reasonable efforts. So therefore, they are the ones who allow the child to remain in care legally, under legal terms. I just learned all this stuff a couple of years ago. You know, they were talking to me about reasonable efforts one day. I had to make believe I knew what they meant. I had no idea what they meant, because I don't call them that, right? Social workers call it, you know, developing a plan with the family, right? And I remember hearing reasonable efforts, and thinking, I better play along with this and make believe I know. But it was exactly the same thing, developing a plan that can reunite the child with their parent or another permanency option. But the issue was is that the authority in the court is very different than the authority that we do. And we play a role in it, but we're a guest in the court, right? And I think one of the things that we've done in different places is, how do you get workers to be able to be more comfortable in court and to be able to stand in court with authority and with confidence, not and respectfully of the court and the court officers, but at the same time realizing that your voice is an important voice in that court and representing the kid. And the legal system in its various forms represents those clients in whatever way those clients say they want to be represented, which might not be what we think the best plan is. So there's a lot of conflict there, but I think I've learned, you know, in New York City, the judge that I worked with when I was a caseworker was Judge Judy Scheinlin. Judge Judy. Okay, and the way she is on TV is exactly the way she was in family court, which is why every time I see her face on TV, I turn the channel, because I find nothing about her funny. She was horrible and hard to deal with and real opinionated and wouldn't let you get a word in edgewise, and it was so frustrating. After a while, once she trusted you, she would ask for your opinion, but it was always a big challenge, and courts are. And I was in court, a court training with judges in Louisiana a couple of weeks ago, and we were talking about that, and I was saying, you know, although you as a judge in the court get frustrated with us who come sometimes not prepared to answer the questions that you pose, because they would tell me, you know, Gary, I ask her what the permanency plan is, and she says adoption, and I say, why is the permanency plan adoption? And the worker says, because my supervisor told me to say that. Or, you know, can you tell us a little bit about the background of the family? And the worker says, well, Your Honor, I just came back from vacation yesterday and I really haven't had time to read the case yet. You know, it was like this infuriated, crazy thing. And again, part of that supervision, right? I mean, I know when I was a younger worker, your supervisor worked with you about going to court. They told you how to dress, right? They made you dress like this if you were a guy. I never would have dressed like this on my own, right? And if you were a woman, you know, they said, you know, don't wear loud colors, don't wear sunglasses, no hats, you know, don't wear open-toe shoes, you know, blah, blah, blah. They went through the whole shtick with you. And we've lost a little bit of that because I think we're in a big rush, right? We have to do the paperwork, and we have to do this. And I think part of it is, how do you really recapture some of those things as a supervisor with new workers to really train them to be able to, and is it possible for you to go with them to court too? Which, you know, you don't really want to, right? Because you know you're going to be there for 8 hours, right? But in the same token, part of it is the way that we supervise new workers. But there's no easy answer. And I mean, I've had judges who listen to me and are great, and ones who don't. I've had guardian ad litem people who are great, and people who, you know, quiz me at the break and then use everything I told them against me. You know, I've learned that one. You know, I did a whole training where I taught workers how not to fall into the pitfalls of working with attorneys, because they would do things like, I had this one attorney, you want to hear what he did? He had there's a shaken baby syndrome thing. He whips out this baby doll from the suitcase, his briefcase, gives it to the worker and says, demonstrate for me how you think that mother shook that baby. And the worker's like going to do it, and the supervisor's like, don't touch that baby. You know, you don't have any idea how that mother did that or not, but she was doing it because the lawyer told her to do it, right?
So, you know, it's that kind of, you know, because you're young and you're new and you don't know and, you know, they have authority and they're telling you to do something. And again, what does that have to do with permanence? Well, it affects the permanency plan that they're then going to agree on or not. You know, and simple things where, you know, people do have bias, right? So that's a little harder to get to. But just educating both our colleagues in the court and ourselves about how to do that better is a big challenge. I did massive training in Louisiana on that, and we did role-playing and moot courts and all kinds of stuff. It helps a lot. And all the seasoned, experienced workers were like, I know how to do this, because they did, you know? And they were trained differently probably too, which is what built their confidence. And the younger workers were like, I'm terrified to go to court, you know? I don't ever want to go to court. But I also got phone calls like 3 weeks later saying, I saw my colleague and he was dressed in a suit and tie and we all joked that you must be going to court and he said, yeah, I am, because I have my court outfit on, which was like, good. There's a little bit of change, right? If you look the part when you go to the court, it's an important thing as well. Other thoughts, comments?
I have a question.
Sure.
You know, one of the things that I see is there's so many different areas that give input in. You know, you've got the foster parents, you've got the youth, you've got the courts, you've got our stakeholders, our private agencies, our residential. And we have to create buy-in and a belief in so many different areas. How do we go about doing that? Because some of our own internal areas sometimes disagree about choices that are made, recommendations that are being given. How do you look at creating like a system-wide buy-in between our stakeholders and department and within the department itself?
Well, I mean, you know, there are people who are expert, really wonderful at building collaboration and building consensus, right? You know, you have certain staff members who I think do that really beautifully and others who don't, right? You know, you have to be able to collaborate and give up something and insist on something, and it's really just a matter of, I mean, and I think the focus always has to be, what's really in the best interest of this kid? I mean, because a lot of people at those tables are talking about things that are not in that kid's best interest. It's easier for the agency. It's cheaper for the agency. It's too hard to do that. I'd have to work at 9 o'clock at night. I don't want to do that. You know, and when you really kind of listen to what people are saying, it's not always about what's best for this child and this plan that you're constructing together. And it's an art, I mean, to really work with people to get them on board. And to build a consensus, does it have to be 100% consensus? It doesn't, right? I mean, you know, there are cast of characters that work in these things that, you know, their opinion's important, but, you know, they're not the lead vote. They're not the only person at that table making a statement about what they believe is right. And then there are other folks who I think have a stronger say and really need to, right? I mean, it's even hard when we bring attorneys to the table. For these permanency roundtables, attorneys don't come. And I kept saying, why not? And they were like, well, it's not part of the process. And I said, yeah, but then you're going to get into court, and you're going to have this beautiful plan, and they're going to get all crazy because they weren't part of the plan. Well, also, kids weren't part of the plan for that. I thought, that's kind of weird, right? So, I mean, sometimes we exclude people intentionally, and maybe that works, and other times to exclude them is a mistake because then they're not going to be part of the process. But I think it's about this kind of gift of being able to build consensus and be able to, you know, work with multiple opinions and have somebody that ties it together and pushes it forward. Usually it winds up being a caseworker, you know, or the supervisor, somebody who has kind of the authority to work with the foster parent and the lawyer and the mental health provider in the community and kind of pulls it all together. And, you know, I think some people have greater talent at that than others, but it's not easy. But it's, again, just because it's not easy doesn't mean it's not possible.
I have a question. So as we are embarking on doing family finding statewide, we've been doing it for a few years under some grant work, and it came out with our fictive kin legislation in this summer. And so the question is, so in the mid to late 90s, we started talking about the first home being the best home to try to reduce moving kids. And one of the questions that we're grappling with our policy work on family finding is, if you're doing it right and you're really identifying resources, first of all, you're not stopping once you find a resource.
Right.
You're continuing to build that, and
right.
that's part of the concurrent planning piece.
Right.
And I like to say that, you know, you're not building a concurrent plan as a plan B, you're building it so that you can maybe support reunification. Because
right.
here's all these people stepping forward that are willing to support and help the parent or
right.
parents, right? So as you, so let's say you have a placement, it's grandma, and grandma is great for the first couple weeks. And then you determine that, well, really, you've got this aunt over here that's really maybe a better potential for a longer term placement. How are jurisdictions handling that in terms of thinking about moving that child or thinking about the longer term permanency needs versus, you know, because the decisions that you make at 4 o'clock in the morning, that's awesome if we found a relative or a kin or somebody that knows the child to be that first placement. It doesn't happen all the time. You know, it maybe happens more than I think, but if it's a relative, what's the thought on then potentially moving that child to a more suitable relative or kin placement?
Yeah, I mean, people have done it differently. I mean, again, partially it always goes back to really what is working best for that child. So does relative A work best or relative B work better? And how do you, in a full and open disclosure kind of context, talk about what is the best interest for this kid? Again, it's complicated, right? It's not. There's no easy answer to it because a lot of it has to do with your ability as a worker to be comfortable having that kind of difficult conversation with both kinship A and kinship B.
Right.
You know, and then making a decision that's really based on, in the long term, what's in the best interest of that particular child. So there's no easy answer, and I think part of it is that, you know, you have relatives that are kind of both related to this child by blood. You have, you know, two people saying, I'd like, and you know, the other issue is how do you help one support the other, right? Maybe one lives with the kid lives with one, but the other one supports that kin. I mean, it's wonderful for a kid to have more than one person. So I think that kind of thing is something to try to think about setting up, you know, and how do you kind of negotiate that situation so that you don't have one person saying, well, you know, I tried to help and they wouldn't even let me help because they told me the other one was better and now I'm annoyed and, you know, I'm not doing this anymore. But in reality, you have two people that really care about this kid. How do you make it work for both of them to be people who care for that kid?
So I get, and I completely agree with everything you're saying. So in terms of policy, I'm thinking that it wouldn't be good to have steadfast policy that says, oh no, you're not going to move that child because that's disruptive. You know, I mean, I see that it's about what's in the best interest of the child and, you know, hopefully they have a child and family team and there, you know, there's multiple people that are providing input on what's best for the child. So in a perfect world, that would all be happening and maybe aunt would be a better longer term solution and grandma's, you know, always in the picture.
Right.
And that's great.
And we don't want to not move that kid because we don't want to get dinged for having another move, right? Because that's what happens. It's like, oh, we're going to get screwed when they do the review, you know, because we moved the kid twice, you know. Yeah, you want first placement to be the best placement and the last placement, and hopefully that works out, but sometimes it doesn't. And you have to, I think, be able to justify that. And I know, I don't admire you for having to put the policy out there because it's a complicated thing to write about, right? Because you want to be able to be thoughtful about making a plan and engage people, and that doesn't always translate really well into policy. But it's one of those kind of amorphous policies that, you know, you want to talk about engagement of families in the best interest of the child and kind of move it from there. I want to also say something about Sari's question. Tell me, I know I'm mispronouncing your name, but
Sari.
Why don't I only call you Sari? One other thing that I would do, just to jump back to that, is if things went bad at that meeting, I would follow it up with a phone call, right? And if I knew somebody was coming to the meeting and they were a big pain in the butt before they even walked in the door, I would call them before the meeting to say, here's what's happening. Like, let me get a little read with you, you know, how you might feel about that. Because that's what you do when you enter a system, right? And you're trying, like, I've learned so much about this from being a faculty member at a school of social work. Because, you know, they have these big faculty meetings and nothing ever happens at these meetings. It all happens before the meeting and after the meeting, right? So I've learned that trick. You know, if I have to speak and I want them to agree with me, I call beforehand and talk to my friends and say, hey, I'm going to be standing up there and please raise your hand and say you think this is a great idea. Or I call the real pain in the butt people and say, I know you don't like me, but last time I supported your thing, can you please like think about being a little, could you at least be quiet, you know? But I think, you know, I don't mean to be that manipulative, but I think you need to really think about how do you get people on board, because one person who's really upset with the decision can derail the whole decision. And if they are somebody who's important, like maybe the guardian ad litem for the kid or something like that, then it becomes a really ugly thing, and you don't want it to stay ugly. And if you know from the get-go it might be ugly, you want to do something that you can kind of assuage it a little bit. Yes, ma'am.
I also don't want to lose the fact that birth parents can be a real determinant.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
And we haven't talked much about that today,
right.
But they can really drive or derail decisions. So when you can, it's good to bring them on board early on.
Yeah.
We just had a really, could have been potentially contentious child and family team meeting. But the mom and the dad came to a decision and just kind of cut the rest of the family out of the decision. And so they thought the caretaker should be, and I think that would happen more than not if we gave them the opportunity to really participate at that level.
Yeah, that's an excellent point, and thank you for making it. And I think also we don't make the environment comfortable enough for birth parents. You know, people start, well, first of all, it's very intimidating to walk into a room with all these professional people sitting around the table, and you're like, wow, I'm just, you know, the parent. But, and that's how you feel. I'm not saying that's how we think of them, but I think the issue is that it's intimidating, and sometimes the language is intimidating, and you want to make it comfortable enough for them, but at the same time, yeah, parents are really, really important, and you might want to have a pre-meeting with them before you have a meeting to kind of, out of respect for them, let them know what's going to happen in the meeting that you're going to be talking about with their child. There's nothing that says you can't do that. But again, it takes a little more time, right? And it takes a little more energy from the worker to say, let me slow it down a bit and like let me give Mrs. Jones a call and talk to her a little bit about what's going to happen tomorrow, so when she walks in, she's not caught off guard, or she's kind of shy anyway. And if we all start talking, she won't say anything. She'll just nod her head and say, uh-huh. You know, and then afterwards, she doesn't really get it. So yeah, birth parents are really important. Reading things for birth parents too, because sometimes some of our families don't have the same kind of reading level, and they'll just nod their head like, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, okay, and they really don't get it. But you know, kind of running through things with people is helpful. And sometimes you get birth parents who are really, really mad at us, right? I mean, they come in there, they're looking for a fight. You know, I've had some of them too. And you know, I didn't always deal with them well, because I was one of those people that, you know, would give it back to them, but so professional, of course, right? But I learned over many years to stop and say, it's, you know, I know you're really angry. I would be angry too if somebody took my child like you think we took your child, but like we're not the enemy, and like we really need to help, you know, work together a little bit. And a couple times they would point things out that we did wrong. And I realized if I could say, you know what, you're right, we did do that wrong. That was stupid, we shouldn't have done that. I promise you we won't do that again. We'll make other stupid mistakes, but we're not gonna make that same stupid mistake again. And that kind of helped people feel a little bit better about, okay, you know, I can hear you. But I think the biggest thing with families is respect, right? Because they're so used to being treated disrespectfully that when you finally call them Mrs. Jones instead of Mary, because they're calling you Mrs. Jones, you know, and you're genuinely respectful, not phony respectful, that goes a long way. And I think families deserve that. And they've been, unfortunately, so accustomed to being treated so poorly by systems that they expect us to also treat them respectfully. So it's a simple thing, but like please and thank you and calling them in a respectful way, but what's, and not having people at that team talk about them like they're not at the meeting. You ever have that happen? I had a psychiatrist, he would talk about them. I would say, Dr. Brummett, they're right here. Don't talk about the client who is mentally ill. And I'd say, he's right here. And talk to him. He had a really hard time with that, because that was not part of the way he was trained. I mean, he was an older guy and he had old school training. But you know, that was really off-putting, because kids would get mad at him and feel he was being disrespectful, and so would families, and he would talk the same way about families. So we had to retrain Dr. Brummett a few times. But excellent point about birth families. Come on, I'm gonna handcuff you all to those bars. I haven't had the chance to use them yet. They're hard to really negotiate around.
In Illinois, we have private agencies that we contract with, and they have over 80% of the cases, and they have worker turnover. So it's hard to get the buy-in because you have new supervisors with new workers. And so trying to get that buy-in and get them all on the same page as the department is really difficult.
Yeah, in New York it was the same. You know, we had, we used to have 63 agencies that contracted with the city of New York to do all of foster care. Now we only have 24 of them because many of them closed or merged. But it's always an issue because the city and the state licenses, the city sets the policy, and then these private agencies contract with the city to provide the services. So they wouldn't exist without the contract. And yet they're a private agency, so they're, some of the things that happen in their agency are beyond their control, like turnover. Right, so it was constantly a how do you get those folks on board to kind of give the same messaging. I still didn't get it. You know what I mean? That from the policy that the city or the state is putting out there, and it's just complicated. And it's really incumbent upon the agency that contracts with you to make sure that happens, because if it wasn't for their contract, they wouldn't exist. And they want that contract because they need to work with us, right? So, but it, and it is a collaboration. So you kind of always have to kind of figure out ways that you can get them. But it's very hard. Turnover is one of the worst things. When I was a foster parent for Leslie, in like 3 years of being a foster parent, we had 9 different workers. And they would all say the same thing. Can you tell me a little bit about how you met and start? All the way back to the beginning. And I would say, we're not going back there. Read the case record. The big giant record like this. We're way beyond that. We'll give you a little quick synopsis, that's it. But it was funny because they didn't mean anything by it, but they didn't know the case. But it was really exhausting after 9 workers to kind of keep doing that. So for me, who was a worker, knowing that, you know, I can't imagine what it's like for families who, you know, feel like they can't even say that because they're going to get in trouble, right? But yeah, the contracting agencies for policies is always a dilemma. You know, you can get bring out the big hammer and say, look, you know, you got to do this. But in reality, the turnover thing is really, because it's all new worker training, right? And the way that we, and then we're constantly re-socializing new workers to the new policies and the new procedures and the new ways of practicing, and it gets really draining. And it gets draining for agencies too, because of the 100 new workers they train, probably 40 of them leave before the end of the year. So that's another, and then they're recycling again. It's huge. Big dilemmas to some extent that we have to are faced with as well. Other comments, questions, thoughts?
Mm-hmm. I think that sometimes we, in looking at our permanency numbers and our permanency rates, you know, for all, not just our older kids, but we kind of get lost in the minutia of risk versus safety. Mm-hmm. Children come into care because of safety issues, not because of risk issues. So when that happens, we keep children in care until everything's done, until safety and risk are extinguished. And the court really holds us to that. It's handled. They don't, they're, everyone's too afraid to say, let's take a chance where you've got the safety thing. Could it pop back up? Absolutely. We have no guarantee when a child goes home regardless. But I think that, and we do that in the same kind of model with residential. A child goes into residential care for a certain particular maladaptive behavior that is not letting them live in a home environment, and then we have to fix everything before they leave.
Right.
And so I think, and then, so then you have parents who say, okay, I've done this, and then something else is added to their service plan.
Right.
And this is added to their service plan.
Right.
No. And so then they start backpedaling because they're, all the fruit of their effort is not making any difference in their mind. And then again, we have children waiting and languishing till everything's done.
Yeah.
Instead of really having more of a supportive model, getting those kids back in the home that looks more like our intact model,
right,
to continue to support them while the safety issue has already been eliminated.
Yeah.
And I think that, I think we lose a lot of families like that. I think kids don't get permanency as quick as they should because of those types of thought process, and not necessarily that it's supported in our policy, but it's really just this old thought process about having that constant, everything has to be done before a kid goes home.
And the parallel process is the worker risk then becomes an issue too, right? If you're worried that every single thing is done, partially you're also worried about your own risk in sending that child home if something happens, right? It's funny, those are excellent points, and I think if you couldn't hear it over here, it was about attending to everything about safety before they can go home, when it's almost at some point those things have been done, but we're still worried about other things. And it's the same process in residential care where kids come in for something specific and then they stay for a long time. And I have a friend who works at Russian immigrants and in Brooklyn. And she was working with a family, and the family kept saying to her, who do we need to pay to get the kid back? And she would say, you don't need to pay anybody. That's not how it works. And they said, no, because in our country, if they take your child away, you need to pay somebody to get them back, because the things you're asking us to do are impossible. Right? So we need to pay you. And I always think about that because it's almost like that. You know, it's like some of the criteria we have are changing the treatment plan or the service plan. You know, the parent did, the parenting class, they did, you know, anger management class, they did, this class, they did. And then we say, oh, and you need to do, you know, this first aid class, and you need to do this class. And the parent is exhausted from trying to do some of their things. So, you know, I think it's how do we monitor that work too, and who makes the decisions about when enough is enough, right? When it's good enough that we've done it. And I don't mean good enough in a sloppy, haphazard way, but I mean, you know, sometimes you make a dinner at night and it's not the best dinner, it's not gourmet, but it's good enough, right? You know, it satisfies you, right? You have some Progresso soup and some old rice, you know. It's good enough, but it's not like gourmet. So, but those are great points, thank you. Are we out of time almost?
We started about 5 minutes.
Okay.
I guess I would comment on what Erica said also, and say that institutionally, I guess as a department, we have to own our role in that. We can't just lay it at the court and say that they don't get that, because I gotta say, by and large, I bet very few of our own workers walk into court and recommend that, because we don't even give, I don't think, probably permission to our field staff to think that way. You know, that risk is okay. Let's talk about sending kids home with maybe some risk, manageable risk. You know, obviously there's risk, right? So I was just thinking that. I was just thinking how we gotta own it too.
Yeah, and maybe we need to think about how do we drill that down to people who are working in the field.
Yeah.
How do we send the message
right,
out
changing
that,
that will
support
you in that?
Well, and I'll add to that and say that sometimes families reach their maximum capacity.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Which
that's a good point.
Is different to us, and we have to decide at that point. This is it.
This is the level
they're going to
get.
Exactly.
It's as good as it's going to get, and is it good enough?
And is it functional?
Yeah.
Or what can we do to support that?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
What can we do?
I guess I'd like to take it a further part further.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that we prepare our staff to help children return home.
Right.
Some of our staff don't even talk to the children about the return home. How do you do that? They talk to the parents. They talk to the foster parents. They don't talk to the child. I don't know if they know how to do that. I remember years ago when I was in adoption, when we were preparing children to be adopted, when we prepared the birth parents, when we prepared the foster parents for that process, we've taken that clinical aspect out of it, but we push the paper. We clearly get our subsidy paperwork and make sure that's all accounted. But even returning children home, how do you do that? I work with birth parents, and one of the things they've said to us in our groups is that we're there. Take their children, we stay there, and then it's time to go home, and they feel like we disappeared.
Yeah.
So how are we preparing these people, clinically, the children, the parents?
Yeah.
I don't think a lot of our social workers know how to talk to us.
Yeah.
We talk to their own at home,
yeah.
But to talk to our wards, it doesn't matter.
And that re-entry process, what she was saying is, do we prepare our young people who are being reunified to be reunified? And do we prepare families for that it too? And part of it is that, you know, it's reentry. So, you know, you've been away from your family. What's it going to be like when you go back now, 6 months later or a year later or 2 years later? You know, and mom has a new apartment, and, you know, mom might have some different rules. And you know how kids are, right? They go right back to the way it used to be, right? So if you know, they never took their shoes off in the house, and now mom's saying, you got to take your shoes off because I got a new house and I got new carpet, and, like, we're going to keep this house clean. They're saying, oh, I ain't doing that, right? Now, they didn't have to do that before. You know, you weren't so strict before, right? So they'll challenge kind of even when things have changed, even though maybe in the other foster home they lived in, that was the rule and it was no problem. But I think it's about the preparation, and it's about the preparation and the support for the family too. I mean, if you're somebody who, you know, like we said, was maybe abusing substances, maybe had some mental health issues, and your kids have been out of your house, and you've kind of been on your own for a while, and now they're back, and five kids are running around the house making a lot of noise, and you have to run around after them, and got to get them to school in the morning. I mean, one of the other, I live in East Harlem too, and I love in the morning when I'm walking my dogs, taking my time before I go to work, I see these mothers with kids, and I think, that poor mother, she's young, she has three kids, and it's 6 o'clock, and she's already up for hours, getting those kids dressed, getting them out in the morning, getting them to daycare, getting them to school, and I'm thinking, that's a lot of work. I'm still in, like, my pajamas practically, walking the dogs, right? And she's, you know, already had to do a bunch of things. And then the reverse of that at the end of the day, right? Getting them back from daycare, getting on a bus, bringing them home, getting on another bus to pick up the other kids at school, and then getting home, and then cooking dinner, and then making sure everybody did their homework, and then making sure everybody gets a bath, and then, you know, those are exhausting things to do if you're a single parent and you haven't done that in a while, right? So that's my thought is that, you know, how would you kind of reorient both mom and the kids to do those things, because those are stressful, tiring tasks that absolutely need to be done. Good point. Okay, well, thank you so much for having me. And good luck.